you rather be than right here, right now?
No, no, no. Yes, here they come. Arnold and 03.
They're coming supporters. These women all say Arnold groped them and it's okay. They have such deep voices. They're lovely.
Hey, hold on. Ignore that.
What do I wear? What do I wear that?
The man is big. A man of hate and a soul torn apart. Viewer discretion advised.
And good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. Elvis's portable phone and all the ships at sea. Quick, subdue them with a fire extinguisher. Don Geronimo and Mike, bi-week, Mara.
And hiya, thank you for listening, everybody. Don and Mike Show, new episode on this Monday, October 6th. Now we're coming to you, via the auspices of Westwood One.
There they are.
Here's our national number from anywhere you hear the show. So generally, we only give the number out once, maybe once an hour. We're not one of those shows that hammers it over and over again. Please call, please call.
Well, let's not be egotistical, but there is no need.
So, call now if you want. Or just don't call later.
Exactly.
Oh, who said? Did he say it?
I said it.
Oh my God!
You gotta be kidding me. In what context?
I hate the hammer alarm.
That word, the number.
Hammer the number.
Yeah. See?
I hate the hammer alarm.
Set off the alarm.
Click, 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 click.
Technically, I said it a second time.
Right, turn it off.
Click, click.
There we go.
Yeah.
Yeah, so a call from anywhere. We occasionally take your calls. We enjoy your calls. 877-365-3636. If you're listening in Canada, Rob, you can call 800-636-1067. In Washington, D.C., you have a special number, 202-432-1067. Here is Paul.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Buzz Burbank here.
Hi there, bud.
Is anyone listening?
Hey, what happened?
Did you wash your ass today?
Someone call for a doctor?
What?
I want to thank
what,
Buzz.
What?
I want to thank Buzz for really finally bringing in some extra large sizes to the Buzz Burbank collection so that I could shop at the Buzz store this weekend. I looked over at you and I feel like we're twin brothers today.
Yeah, we can do an act.
Yeah, it's fresh off Moomin Shots. There we go. You know, when he got the Husky sizes in, I was just so thrilled with that. You wearing denim also on the,
the
waist?
Yeah, we're both with long sleeves,
white sneakers,
sweaters. No, I have boots.
Oh, you have boots.
Yeah.
I blew it.
Yeah,
sorry.
Nobody got the memo on this side of the room. Orange t-shirt.
What was that? Hunting season has started, or what?
Orange t-shirt and a flesh-colored, Caucasian-colored sweater vest.
Would you be on a Clemson kick? Is that what it is?
Oh, no, they got their asses kicked this weekend.
Well, just the clothing. That's another another orange. That's Clemson orange you're wearing.
No, see, but it's a Nike, just a regular Nike t-shirt.
Okay.
Just trying to throw some color into the wardrobe over here.
Yeah, I know, because we're all very in the... Then you've got Kevin Arnold over there.
Look
here
at the boy wearing his Kevin Arnold rugby shirt.
It's Eddie Bauer, of course. Hello.
Starring in the new movie, Kevin Arnold Loses His Hair.
Oh, ouch. So let's get right to it, because today's going to be jammed, and we're going to be trying out a brand new game later today.
Ooh. Very exciting.
It's called Can You Hear Me Now?
Can you hear me now?
Well, I'll tell you.
All right.
I think it's a good one. A brand new one. We'll lay it on you today. Before I even talk about the joy that I had this weekend with my son and with my family, because my son was in from college.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, what show person today? Today isn't thinking about Roy Horn.
No.
Getting mauled and carried off the stage in Las Vegas.
Here at the Don and Mike Show, our prayers were with him all weekend. When we got the news yesterday that he indeed was stable, tears all throughout the camp.
Yeah.
It was very, very exciting.
A rough weekend.
And a lot of you fantasy football players wonder what happened to the New Orleans Saints yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I tell you what. Let's say that your name is... Well, let me just say you wear number 87. I didn't even have to look it up in the paper. And your name happens to be Joe Horn, wide receiver for the Saints, and you realize that as you're out to play a meaningless football game, your long-lost brother, Joe Horn, Roy Horn, somewhere, he's in a hospital somewhere.
Right, yeah. Fighting for life.
How do you catch the ball?
I know.
How do you catch
it? Right.
And then I come in and I read the headline, The Siegfried and Roy Show Likely Won't Go On.
Uh-huh.
And then a sad postscript from me. And this is a show that Rob Spiewak and I walked out on just months ago.
I remember when you guys were talking about this and, you know, how you just couldn't stand it.
Didn't even take the time to finish my tepid draft beer.
Wouldn't you have stayed if you'd seen a white tiger grasping one of the hosts by the throat and dragging him off
God.
The stage?
Yes. Yes, we would have.
We would have. Horn would have made us stay in our seats.
What does the cousin say? Has anyone got a quote from the cousin?
Shoe?
He's
Shoe Horn.
You know who's keeping an all-night vigil is Aunt Lena.
Really? He had a football player in the NFL too. His I think it was a brother or cousin. I'm not sure. Bull.
Well,
famous
the Horn.
College running back Bull Horn
and his Swedish cousin Flugel.
Okay, guys. Okay, we're not playing the Horn game right now.
Sorry about that.
We're trying to have a serious moment here.
Sure, I know. This is really not in the best of taste.
Would you give me the prayer music?
Yes.
You know, that low,
is appropriate.
Because I just want to send out, take a second, because I know later in the show we're going
to
be...
And Rob, it has to be an appropriate first name, too. Like, Flugel wouldn't work.
If he was Swedish.
But if it was, you know, like William French Smith.
No.
It'd be William French Horn.
Yeah, no. Yeah. Doesn't work. Yeah. Doesn't work.
Yeah.
Later in the show, we're going to be doing something about this that may be considered tasteless.
Let me take
this opportunity to say, on behalf of the entire Don and Mike Showbiz family,
amen,
that some people read about celebrities and think they have a knowledge of them. It's not until you actually go to see that celebrity that you really make that one-on-one connection. When you're sitting in the audience and the spotlights come out, and it says, Siegfried, 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 Roy, 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 and you're sitting there, having your watered down two-drink minimum, which they bring both at the same time, and then at one point, approximately 11 minutes into the show, you look at your friends as they look at their watch, and you walk out of the show. And now I think, if only I would have stayed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hope.
Maybe that tiger would have gone crazy that night.
Yeah.
Back in what month were we there, Robbie? Was it April, something like that?
I think it was May.
April or May. My gosh, just 4 or 5 months earlier, I could have been there. And I know what you're thinking. How awful of you to say that.
What a horrible thing to say.
Let me say this.
How awful of you to say that, Don.
Maybe I could have helped.
That's right. Do you think you would have sprung? Where were you in proximity to the stage when you were there? Were you up close?
Not necessarily, no.
Were you springing distance?
But you know me, yeah. Mm-hmm. If there's a problem, boom, I'm Johnny there.
Would you have been helping? Roy or the lion?
I would have been helping Roy because, like Roy,
yes.
You're going to hear me say this throughout the show today. Don't kill the tiger.
That's right.
Roy has...
Keep the kitty.
Roy has come out, apparently he's in and out of this, whatever it is, this life and death situation he's in.
I think he's stable. That's what the most recent is he's stable. They hit the tiger over the head.
The fire extinguisher.
What I'm curious about is why nobody poked the eye of the tiger. I'm just curious about that.
That's a good question.
But in all seriousness, why didn't they go for the tiger's eyes? You know, I mean, hell, that's what I would have done.
Too close to his teeth, I think.
Anyway... What can I say? I was there. I was close.
Mm-hmm.
I would have been close enough to do something.
Could have been there.
But if nothing else, I would have been able to bring you a unique perspective that you're not hearing yet. Mm-hmm. What was it like? Because there were 1,500 people crammed into that same ass-smelling theater that Rob and Carrie and I were crammed into.
Is it crass of me to ask why no one has any video of this?
Mike, and this is... What's equally perplexing?
Especially when you watch the movie Ocean's 11 and you realize that the eye in the sky, even in the theater, watches everything. And I would assume that every single show was taped.
You would think.
You know, and...
They showed tape from over a year ago where they showed the same lion, tiger, doing tricks with Roy Horn.
Horn.
Roy Horn, who's...
You think there's a secret tape that exists of the attack?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Probably. I think there is.
Oh, yes.
Must be.
And with 1,500 people, what I'm surprised is that we haven't turned on, it wouldn't be until tonight, Entertainment Tonight or Access Hollywood, one of those shows that's gone to these people and said, you know, were you there?
I was there. Oh, they had an interview. They had a guy interviewed.
Really?
Yeah, they had and he was just like
that. They said dragged him off like a rag doll?
Yeah, the guy that I saw interviewed said they thought it was part of the act.
Right.
Until they realized something was terribly wrong. I think perhaps until they saw the massive blood loss.
Quarts and quarts of blood.
Well.
Those tigers know how to kill a human.
Oh, yeah.
They do.
He comes down with something.
Unexpected,
real,
Rob.
Real unexpected.
Very unexpected.
So anyway.
Horn.
That's our lead story today. Roy Horn.
That's right.
A nation wonders. Mm-hmm. Will this show ever come back? And this is the wrong time to bring it up, but I'm going to bring something up that I alluded to years ago on this show. I think we had a roundtable discussion, much like Menudo. Over the years, haven't they just changed Siegfried and Roy's?
Rotating them in?
I don't think so, but
do you mean
could.
Like when a certain voice changes that you'll pop in? Because they really do look vaguely similar. Do you think they get look-alike?
Well, the thing is, you never really see them. I mean, and even if you go there, you don't really see them.
No,
they've always got this bad ELO lighting on them. And I think, Rob, how long ago was it? It was years ago, but we did have the discussion on the show.
Yeah, and haven't they been performing in Vegas for like 35 years?
Yes.
They don't seem to be aging. What's up with that?
You know, and we're not even getting to the whole living together thing. I'm just saying that it was a theory that they were simply shuffling in new Siegfrieds and new Roys.
So is your theory that if indeed the tiger had finished off Roy Horn, that the show would go on with a different Roy, or they would keep it a conspiracy?
You can't come back right away because there are 1,500 witnesses.
Right.
So what you do now with Roy Horn now, if I'm running the show, and I know that I've got another Roy ready to come out,
right,
mm-hmm. So to speak.
See, but this is what makes it harder. Now there are real photos on the internet and in the newspaper of what Roy Horn looks like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This may put the duplication Roy's make all of them null and void.
I think so.
I don't want to be a conspiracy theorist, but did the lion go for his face?
His neck.
No, his neck rub.
But
his neck.
Couldn't that be enough to say, he looks different? Well,
yeah, he had to have surgery.
Some surgery was done.
Yeah, and then like a guy comes out with that looks like Carrot Top.
You know, all of the computers have crashed in here, and I really need some help from Charlie or...
Joe.
No, Charlie, if you would come in for a second, please. They've all gone dead, and I see on one of these lines is some guy calling from Las Vegas who said he was at the show.
Oh, my God.
Now, it might be a bogus call. It might be.
You never know.
But I can't tell because we
1,500 people at the show?
Yeah. We have 12 lines on hold, and I have no way of telling. You see that, Charlie? That one's dead. Man.
Ow. 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 Ow.
What the hell is that?
Ow. I think that was only audible in our headphones, perhaps.
No, that was on the air feed.
That was on the air?
That was on the air? We apologize to anyone in our audience who might be sterile.
No.
Hey, Al. How about my macho reaction, though, huh? How about that?
What'd you do?
I just went, ow, ow, ow.
Don't hurt me.
Stop it.
Ow, ow. You're hurting my ears.
That's called white noise.
Yes.
Oh, and...
I like that guy.
Listen,
you do, Rob.
As long as we're on the topic. Oh, and you must be happy today.
Yeah.
You got the place to yourself today. You had no problem getting a parking spot today, did you?
It's terrific, isn't it?
As long as we're on the topic of this studio.
Yes.
Here's a game we're going to play today. It's called Count the Number of Light Bulbs. And these are not just light bulbs. This is track lighting that we have in the studio. These are big, like French fry lights.
That's right.
Let's count how many are out, non-working. I count. One, two, three, four. I can't reach those.
Five, six.
This one's out.
Seven, eight.
Eight out of a possible 12.
Eight out of 12. We're doing the show like pioneers in here now. We don't even have the proper lighting to turn on the lights to do the show.
And they haven't even given us candles, which I think is a nice thing to do.
It is.
Hi, Charlie.
I'd like to be able to help you with your computers, but since there is no engineer here,
I think they're
sharing cluster duties.
Oh, boy.
They won't be fixing it.
Here we go with that synergy. Yeah. How about light bulbs? Anybody know where the light bulbs are around here?
There are.
Because I'll change those myself.
They aren't here. They're a little bit expensive, so they They don't come in that often.
Oh, hold on. Joe just fixed it.
Yeah, they go to sleep.
Pardon? The computer.
Pardon me, Joe?
Joe.
Who goes to sleep? Our listeners?
No, the computers do.
Duh.
Well, now if you're going to say
duh. No, I'm saying duh.
You didn't fix it. You didn't fix it.
I'm saying duh to me. I didn't even think that that's what it was.
Yeah. I love it, Joe, though. Sometimes simplicity works.
When they go to Joe, sleep, we just need to get in there during a break and set the sleep time longer.
This man is on a roll, ladies and gentlemen.
Congratulations, Joe Ardinger.
This man is on a roll.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not on a roll this weekend. If you heard me on the show on Friday when we had the beautiful Nancy on, I was screaming that I was sure, beyond the shadow of a doubt, to lay all your money, all of your children's money, on the Detroit Lions. They were the absolute lead pipe, cannot lose the game pick of the week for me.
Did I go along with you?
No, you took the other team.
I took the Niners?
Yeah. And Nancy agreed with me. And boy.
Did I have the best record this week?
I don't know. Buzz, do you have that stuff?
Let me check. I'm going to have to check the scores. That's the only game I now know the results of.
What are the other games? I'll tell you.
I can tell you what your picks were.
Just tell me. Kansas City.
And Denver.
Mm-hmm. Kansas City won.
Okay.
God, winning is becoming a habit.
Seattle and Green Bay.
I know I took Seattle.
Right. So did I. So did Jim. Mike took Green Bay.
All right. Mike won that one.
Okay. Detroit, San Francisco, we covered. Washington, Philadelphia.
I think I took Philly.
I think I took Washington.
Yeah, Mike and I took the Skins, and you and
that's a big one.
Jim took Philadelphia. The Tampa Bay and the Colts. Don took Tampa Bay. Mike took Tampa Bay. I took the Colts, and Jim took Tampa Bay. So that's how that went.
So, listen, give that paper to Rob, and Rob will be able to tell us exactly who has what. As we continue,
all right. If he can read it, we could be here all week.
As we continue to pick the pros,
might not want to give it to me. Mike seems to be the big winner this weekend. in a variety of ways, but I don't want to talk about the one way. I'll talk about fantasy football. I'm very happy that my fantasy team won again, but I don't want to say anything
about the Red Sox.
Hi.
You've already jinxed it. You jinxed it yesterday afternoon when you called after they won the game.
We covered them all.
That is the official jinx. Thanks, Charlie. Here's the information.
Well, wait, you claimed that I jinxed it for getting into the postseason when I called you.
Maybe I'm wrong about that. Hold on. Total right this week. Here we go. Total right this week. Mike had three right.
Yay, Mike!
I had two right, and Nancy had two right, and of course, then we got tonight. So it looks like you'd be the leader in this as well.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And
yeah, I don't want to, but I don't think I didn't jinx them when they went to the. Look, can I explain that to you? And I want you to accept this because you have a problem with this. I don't have a lot of people to call when are really plugged into my sports thing. They're really not.
This is why very soon, coming soon, Mike O'Mara is the Bachelor.
Yeah, whatever. But the thing is, I called everybody that mattered. In the area that would understand how into it I was, and you were on that list. It was not
appreciated.
It's not a gloat call. The gloat call would have been that other call that I made to you, or did I make it, or did I just talk about it?
No, you called me a couple of times yesterday. The second time you called me was about your concern that the start time of the Red Sox game was going to be while our show was on.
Yeah, which I thought was the start time, like up until my drive in here today, and until one of my assistants enlightened me to the fact that it was an 8 o'clock game when I was having a conversation with him. I was having a conversation with one of my assistants.
Okay.
My only assistant.
Yeah, Raymond Diaz.
Thank you, Raymond.
So Mike calls yesterday to say this, you know, he calls me and says, well, they've done it.
I called with a joke.
Here's what I want to say.
I called, you know what I said? Don't you remember what I said? It was
remember
funny.
Remember exactly what you said. You said, they've done it to me again.
What?
The first thing you said is they did it to me again.
No, I said I'd like the day off tomorrow.
Oh,
remember?
Correct.
Because I thought it was going to be a 4 o'clock game today.
And then you said they did it to me again, and I was expecting to hear the loss. He said they came back in the eighth inning.
Yeah. Yeah.
They pulled it out. They won. They won the game.
Now you could look at this as, hey, this is exciting. They have a fifth game. No, I look at this based on history. And my nephew said it to me quite clearly last night. He said, "Well, Uncle Mike, the fact is, you've been rooting for them a lot longer. I haven't gone through these things that you have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I said, I look at it as a more dramatic way to perhaps break my heart, but I'm still there, just like I was there for the, you know, when they were down. But somebody wrote it in the Boston Globe that everybody went through. We were depressed, and then we were accepting of the fact, hey, that's the way it's going to go. Now it's a surprise, but now there's that optimism with a little dread.
Oh, yeah.
And if I could just take a moment, baseball is Mike's thing, but I have to speak for people, like-minded people like myself, who must at this point say something about the Red Sox fans.
Yes.
That even though, and I'm not jumping on their bandwagon, I'm not wearing my Cubs jersey today.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't worn it for 10 years. I don't follow baseball.
But it's tempting, isn't it?
I want to say
it's
for those people.
Tempting.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, it is.
And you know, sure.
How can you not? That's okay. I mean, if the Red Sox don't make it, I'm going to jump on the Cubs bandwagon.
But here's the thing. Here's the point. And I talked to some of my friends back in the Chicago area last night.
Right.
And got this vibe over the telephone when they were drunk and screaming and very happy and saying, yeah, you know, you'd love this. Now, these guys don't know. I've not had the heart to tell them over, because we never talk about baseball.
We only
talk about radio.
What were you going to tell the Cubs fans?
Okay, here's what I want to say to the Cubs fans. And, Mike, I'm not talking to you.
Okay.
But I'm saying to Cubs fans, wouldn't you really, at this point, with who has suffered the most,
right?
The fact that the Cubs, for the first time since 1908, were able to win a playoff series.
Right. Is it really? Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Wow.
Means much more than Red Sox, who have been to, in my lifetime, three World Series. And have just, at least they've made it to the World Series.
Oh, I agree.
The Cubs have never even won a freaking postseason game.
I agree with you.
A series. They've never won a series.
And I love the reaction of the Cubs fans.
They win the series, but there is this underlying anger towards the Red Sox fans that I got.
From Cubs fans?
Yes, like.
Because we're getting all the loser credit?
This is all the story about, they've been losing. Hey, just because we don't walk around with signs that say, you know, we suck and we support our team, this is what
that's not what the signs say.
This is what I was getting from my buddies last night.
Reverse the curse. That's the big loser sign that they say. 1908 since they won a playoff series?
Yes.
Wow.
So my friend who
last
night...
What's going to happen if the Cubs, by some miracle, the Cubs and the Red Sox end up in the World Series?
I'll tell you what you do. You max out your charge cards, because that's when it's happening.
Yeah.
That's when the apocalypse is happening.
That's when dinosaurs roam. It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
So don't worry about it. But I'm on the phone with a friend, and he's drinking old-style beer.
Of course.
Now, there's nothing more Chicago than old-style beer. And he was...
Does part of you want to just, I mean, when you see the fans, I mean, really, I mean, watching, they've been great. I mean, the Marlins also, great playoff baseball. But the fact is, when you look at Wrigley and you see those fans there, I mean, it's probably the most exciting postseason there's been in quite some time. It's a lot of fun. There are a lot of teams that are coming back from being down. There are a lot of teams that are, you know, they're going to five games. But the Cubs... You know, I mean, I remember you.
I remember you with the whole uniform on. I speak for Cubs fans, even though I am officially not one of you anymore.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
It doesn't mean...
I know you are. I know your heart, and I know deep inside of you that you are a Cubby.
But here's the thing.
And we could have a great war.
I'm not gloating about the Cubs. I'm not taking any credit. I'm not jumping on any bandwagon. I'm saying, on behalf of those who did better than I, who didn't get pissed off and just walk away.
Who stayed with the team.
For those who stayed with it, you're goddamn right. How come the Chicago Cubs in Chicago doesn't get the credit
for
being the biggest losers?
Right.
And your reaction, the reaction of Red Sox fans, with that indignance, to be the losers?
No. I mean, I'm saying I have an answer for that.
Yeah?
Well, the thing is... I hate to start like Dennis Murphy,
no.
But this is the thing, okay? This is the heart of the matter. Yes, you are absolutely right that the Cubs have not been to championship games and not been to World Series. Thusly, the Cubs have not been able to lose those World Series and Championships games and playoffs for the postseason in spectacular form, in heart, gut-wrenching. That's the whole deal. That's what
this is apples and oranges now, and now it's who's the biggest loser. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sure if you went to a Cubs fan and said,
I mean,
here are your two options. You can go, and now I see up on the screen, it might be 1945. So even if it's 1945, I thought it was 08 as well.
1945 since they won a playoff game?
Since they were in a series. 1945 since they
were in a World Series.
Yes.
They've been in a division championship.
Since then, and they've never won.
Right. Okay.
So it's been at least, 40 years, whatever. In that time, the Red Sox...
So in that 40...
So I'm saying if you went to a Cubs fan and said, here are your choices. You can have a team that gets to the playoffs pretty regularly... Occasionally, we'll go all the way, and they'll break your heart once in a while,
right.
But they'll get to the World Series three times.
Yep.
At least two of those three times, they're going to have legitimate shots of winning.
Yep.
They're going to F it up,
yep.
But you're going to be in a World Series, or you could be a Cubs fan, and once every 10 years, your team will make the playoffs, but you'll never win. You'll never get out of the first round.
Isn't it amazing how incredibly pathetic this discussion is? Isn't it sad? It really is. You want the mantle for your Cubbies fans as the biggest loser? Absolutely. I give it to you. But you know what? You haven't been winners. But you haven't been cursed. You have not been cursed.
Okay.
And you know what? This could all change.
The curse.
This could all change. I'll let you know tomorrow.
The curse is bull.
I'll let you know. I like that. I'll accept that. But I don't. I'm not prepared to believe it.
Mike, hold on a second. Now that we have this, here we go. Steve in Las Vegas says he was at the Siegfried and Roy Horn show.
Wow.
Siegfried and Roy Horn show guy. Are you there?
I was there.
Now, were you really there? Where is it held?
It's held at the Mirage. I got comped the tickets, otherwise I wouldn't have paid to see that show.
It is at the Mirage, correct?
Yeah, anybody that drives down the strip would know that.
I've seen it before. I took my daughter just because somebody comped me the ticket. But I think you've seen it before. It isn't the best of shows at all, but this was definitely the highlight of it.
All right, well, tell us.
Did they give free cell phones away at the show?
Tell us what you saw. This man allegedly was at the Siegfried and Roy Horn show.
Right. I mean, at first the Tiger kind of patted his arm like he was playing, and then Roy kind of turned to him to, kind of scold him for pawing at his arm, and then the Tiger just kind of reached over and grabbed him by the throat, took him down, and just dragged him behind the curtain, and couldn't see anymore after he went behind the curtain.
Oh, so couldn't see anymore after he dragged him behind the curtain?
What was the reaction of the audience?
Well, I didn't find it was part of the show. I'd seen it before, so I knew. Yeah, he wasn't part of the show.
Did you hear any screaming?
It was definitely one of the best special effects they've ever had in their show.
Did you hear any screaming?
No.
At what point did they come out and tell you that Roy Horn had been mauled?
Just later, the show kind of went on for a while, and then What's-His-Name came out and told everybody that they, that wasn't part of the show and that the show...
Who's What's-His-Name? Siegfried?
Siegfried.
You want to know the mentality that goes to a Siegfried and Roy?
Are you talking about Siegfried Fischbacher? Is that who you're speaking of? Siegfried Fischbacher?
Yeah, the real Siegfried.
That's right, Siegfried Fischbacher, yes. Or have they been replaced?
Is it really Fischbacher?
Yes.
Fischbacher.
He's the blonde.
And then last night they did this big candlelight vigil at the hospital, rooting him on, but... I guess saying God Save the Queen or whatever they're doing.
How old is the daughter you took to the show?
10.
10. How's she doing?
Fine.
Okay, good.
She was there to see the animals.
Well, I guess if he wasn't...
then she must be happy because the animals won.
Yeah.
I guess if he wasn't dragging them all over stage and blood was splattering into the audience,
right.
That would have been really cool. But no, it was just kind of dragged them right off the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is the beauty of having a nationally syndicated show, that you can go right to where the hot Roy Horn action is. Thank you.
Don't you want to know what celebrity I most resemble?
Can you tell me, was the Tiger a Cubs fan or a Red Sox fan?
Good question.
It was a White Tiger, so I'd have to say White Sox.
White Sox fan.
White Sox.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Okay, Rob.
Thank you, and goodbye now.
Bye.
Bye forever.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Fine.
Bye then.
Okay.
That was great.
So, here's what I think. You want to know what I think? Just based on our previous discussion?
Yeah.
I think that in your own way, what you just came out and said,
yeah,
is that if it does happen, I think you're trying to distance yourself from baseball. You are trying to say, but I know, I remember.
Listen, I would be happy.
What a Cubs fan you were, and I know that you're watching it, and I know you're keeping an eye on it, and I know you're into it, and you're not going to tell anybody you're into it, but I know you care. I know you care. It's impossible.
A little bit,
Okay, sure. Good. I'm glad you admit to that.
A little bit, sure. Of course I do. Now, not enough.
If they go to the World Series, is there a chance you would pop in here with a Cubs jersey that you haven't worn in years and years?
No, I won't do that.
Still angry. This man, ladies and gentlemen, was burned by the baseball strike. He never came back. He is still angry.
Yep.
He is not. Burn him once. That's all there is to it.
Doing fine without him.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. And let that be a lesson to the Fantasy Football League, although everybody will get their chance tomorrow on this show to say it, like in the case of Mike, how great his team did, and Buzz, how great his team did. I will use that opportunity tomorrow to tell you about the new team I've drafted in my new league at NFL.com.
Is that when we'll have to find out whether you grabbed a W yesterday at all in your new league?
No. My new league doesn't start until this coming weekend.
Ah, okay.
So I got a little grace period there. But I had a thrill filling out my roster. You know, and Frieda said to me at one point, when I was sitting at the computer, I said, look what I've done to the roster.
Right.
I made all of the players inactive.
Uh-huh.
So that it said you have an illegal roster.
Right.
You'll get 0 points.
Right.
And she said, what are you doing? I said, I'm setting my roster.
Mm-hmm. You're protesting.
She said, right, but you quit that league. I said, I know I quit the league.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm putting in the roster so that there's no way that my team just happens to score a few points.
Right.
I don't even want one guy in there. And she said, well, now why? You paid to be in this league. You you played to be with these guys. You like these guys. You like playing against these guys. And I said, yeah, but I'm mad at Charles Broyhill.
Yeah, you lodged a protest, and this is you'll be protesting for the rest of the season.
Absolutely. And I can't help but notice that still on the front page of our webpage for our Fantasy Football League, the news item is still up there from last year when Charles Broyhill did the exact same thing.
Who's responsible for updating our material on the webpage?
I think Rob is the one that updated it, saying, Charlie, update it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Right? You're the one that put the picture up, right?
Good picture. I think everyone will enjoy it. But I just thought it was time we update, at least to this season.
Man, absolutely. And we certainly ought to have a little coverage, a little article on the protest by Mr. Geronimo.
No need. And as a matter of fact,
hey, I mention Roy Horn.
There is a need, you know.
You know what you do? What you do is you take the team apart, and you have like a draft of the players for the other teams.
Now, Rob, you and I had the discussion where I said it's off the site. I showed you it was off the site. Why did you leave that out just now?
What's off the site?
About last year.
The picture.
Right. About last year's news.
No, but he was still saying it's popping up. It wasn't on my. It wasn't on yours, but it was on mine.
Saw it this morning.
It's still on mine too, Charlie.
And Charlie has left the studio. What's going on? What I missed all that. What?
About the fact that on the front page of our website
is the same the story about Charlie leaving the league last year.
You get it on your when you sign on?
Yeah.
So it is there.
So it's still there. But, you know, that's neither here nor there.
There ought to be a little something. There ought to be something about you being out this year.
No, I don't think so. And I think that, you know, I'm the one that, you know, as Frieda said to me over and over, you're just cutting off your own nose to spite your face. And I said, you know, I don't care. It's not fun. And I've gone into great length about why I feel the way that I feel. I said, I feel better joining this other league, you know, getting a team and then still following and following with all you guys.
Well, it's a bummer. It's a bummer for the rest of the league. I mean, it's fun to have, you know, to have the most vocal participant involved in the weekly game.
I'd love to have everybody play again next year, including Charlie Broyhill.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd love for there to be either the computer does the commissioning,
right,
or an outside person who we pay like we all paid Charlie this year.
Well, we've had controversy year after year.
Mm-hmm. Is the commissioner. Anyway, enough of that, because that was a small pimple on what otherwise was the unblemished ass of a beautiful weekend I had in between my constant calls out to Las Vegas. my son came home, and that was beyond great. He was here, but he wasn't here. He arrived on Friday. His girlfriend picked him up at the airport. They came over to the house. They chatted with us for the approximate time that parents have to chat with their college kids. Then
that's how it works. Then they want to go see their pals.
Then they went down to the basement.
Mm-hmm.
to watch a movie.
Oh, okay. Well, he stayed in the house. Sure.
So they stayed in the house. It was nice. He got up the next day. He's gone.
How long has he been gone? A month? Month and a half?
Not that we're counting, but 5 weeks.
Six weeks. Okay.
6 weeks. So he was out doing what he had to do. He was coming in, going out. I'll get into greater detail about the experience I had going to the University of Maryland Stadium yesterday for the Clemson Maryland game. Mm-hmm. We went because that's where, you know, Bart's going. And
right. You didn't wear the orange jumpsuit, did you?
Freed as an alumni, no. No, I didn't. Although, let me say, in the room that we were in before the event, if I had worn the orange running suit, I would have been not even in the top 50% of crazy outfits that people crazy were wearing. The crazy outfits.
Hanky-panky.
That the candidates sang about the hanky-panky. Which he said yesterday. I'm watching Sam Donaldson.
Right.
And they got Peter Jennings talking to Arnold Schwarzenegger saying, six more women have come out to say you groped them. And Arnold's response is, well, that was a long time ago, and some of it might be true, but everybody wants to focus on the hanky-panky, and you can ask anyone from Twins. They've all signed the affidavits. So now I have answered your question. Let's talk about Gray Davis.
Yeah. Oh, good. Wow.
And you people.
He's going to win.
You people are going for that tomorrow. Look,
I know. You people in California.
Full happen. Coverage on this show tomorrow. And I'm listening to Rush Limbaugh today.
No.
Because I was, I said originally, if it was me, I wouldn't have fired him from ESPN. He said something stupid, but they hired him to say stupid stuff. Yesterday, these guys from ESPN, I happened to watch that show at 11 o'clock, mm-hmm. like I happen to every week, and they came on, and it was not like any other football show I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
They came on, and normally, you know, there you have three levels of your football show. You have the Fox, which is virtually cartoon-like, the way that those guys, you right. know, jump on each other and right. give each other noogies and stuff. And then you go to CBS, where you've got a little gentle pushing or shoving and, you know, right. oh, come on.
A little more controlled.
Mm-hmm. Then you go to ESPN, and this is where these guys, they're intense, but there's no room for funny business.
No.
It's, welcome to another great Sunday in the NFL!
You got your Chris Berman, you got your Michael Irvin, you got your Steve Young, right? And Tom Jackson, is that the
that's the lineup?
Okay.
And then sitting at the children's table was Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah.
But even with all of the, even with Rush Limbaugh and without him before that, they were always the show. We're in your face. We're dynamic. We're not like the other guys. We take it seriously. So,
we've got a serious thing. We're going to talk about the serious games. Now, here's the next piece.
Right? It's in your face.
Mm-hmm. So I'm watching the show and the graphics come on. The helmets are smashing and they're talking about, in Kansas City, Will Priest home. Blah, blah, blah. They come back. It's Chris Berman, and he is nervous, and he says, well, basically, I'm going to quote Rudy Martsky, because Rudy wrote about it in his column with all the quotes. I watched it, I hung up the phone, I called Charles Broyhill, and I said, I hope we have tape on this, because I just saw these guys on ESPN sell out Rush Limbaugh
wow.
faster and louder than you've ever imagine.
Good.
You know.
And I'm not saying that from a broadcaster point. I'm taking that from a personal point.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing. They get on, Chris Burton, and you got to listen to Rudy's description of this as well.
Right.
NFL Countdown countered with extraordinary television. Heartfelt, gut-wrenching apologies from the cast, especially Chris Berman, for missing the chance a week ago to quickly reject Limbaugh's off-base agenda. Berman said, I've been kicking myself all week. We're all very sad. Then you had Steve Young coming on and making his apology.
Right.
Then you had Michael Irvin coming on and making his apology. Mm-hmm. And then you had, at least the only guy that, for my money, had the balls to say what he really thought was Tom Jackson.
Okay. And he was the only guy that said it at the time when Rush Limbaugh was on, right?
And he said, you know, they don't tell us what to say around here. And Rush Limbaugh was never a fit and, you know, indicated that he never should have been hired. And mm-hmm. they got done with this, and it was about 10 minutes of real serious.
So Tom Jackson came out and said he was never a fit?
Yeah, Tom Jackson is the only one that actually came.
Had the balls to really just
over the top.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And I appreciate that. The other guys, you know, shut up, Chris Berman. You know, you're the chunky host of the show. That's what you're. We love your enthusiasm, but really, you're nothing. You're nothing. You're just like us. You're a big fat blob.
But he certainly got an interesting point.
and I like him, but I found uncomfortable the entire serious tone. Now, this was a. Keep in mind also that the fact that these guys hadn't commented on all this stuff. And
well, didn't you get the impression, too? You had said this because I think you saw it. You said that Tom Jackson was the only one that was legitimately pissed when it happened, right?
So here's the thing throughout the week. This is something that happened on ESPN. The announcers decided that they were not going to comment throughout the entire week. Now, why you wouldn't want to if it was so important, I don't know. I'm going to make a Leah Remedy point here, and I'd say it about us. The truth is, those guys didn't say anything during the week. Because they wanted you to turn on TV Sunday morning at 11 o'clock so that they could have their soapbox.
Exactly,
I dig that. It's called directing audience. But these guys didn't want to take any credit. They made it sound like doing something noble by saying, we've not spoken for the last week, and now we're going to speak. And they took it all so goddamn seriously. So, point being, I think today I'm coming into work. I'm going to turn Rush Limbaugh's show on.
Sure. Right.
Because he's still got those 4,000 pills hanging over him. And I guess on Friday.
When are you supposed to make his big announcement today?
Yeah. Well, when I turned it on for, I don't know, the 10, 15 minutes that I listened, all I heard was him talking about how the left is damaging Arnold Schwarzenegger's credibility.
Oh, God.
And how could you possibly accuse this man? And then the funniest thing, now I don't listen to Rush Limbaugh a lot, but I'll tell you, I listen to everything on the radio. You know that. I'm a radio junkie. I found this hilarious, and at first almost thought I was being goofed if I realized I wasn't listening to such a piss-poor station as WMAL.
Right.
Couldn't do anything creative if they were forced to. He goes, so that's my fossil Schwarzenegger. I'll be back on the EIB. And then the bumper is something that says, along the lines of integrity, honesty, fairness, Rush Limbaugh.
And now, that can't be new.
No,
there's no way they put that into circulation.
It's got to be also goes, Rush Limbaugh, WML. Then they go to the commercial. And it's a read by Rush Limbaugh. And if this doesn't sound like a parody, ladies and gentlemen, you suffer from serious pain.
Oh, God.
If so, let me tell you about a cream. It's Flexo something cream.
Flexol?
Maybe it's Flexol. Flexol. And you can take this commercial and isolate it and take the sound bites out. And at one point he actually says, ladies and gentlemen, if you're talking about serious pain, I know something about that. This is L. Rushbo telling you to get this pain medication. And I'm looking at this thinking, okay, let's say they're a client, which obviously they are. Somebody from Rush Limbaugh's show has got to go into the same type of control that airlines use. God forbid, whenever a plane crashes, the first thing the airlines do is they call every radio and TV station, and they say, cancel all ads for all airlines immediately.
Mm-hmm.
That's just standard procedure.
Right, right.
You would think Rush Limbaugh is in the news for 4,000 pills. He happens to do commercials where he identifies himself as El Rushbo and associates himself with
pain. Well, it's amazing that you heard that commercial based on Friday's show. He was talking about pain quite a bit. Pain was kind of the centerpiece of everything.
Anybody who listened, I know, you know.
But today was supposed to be the day he was supposed to come out.
I didn't hear it.
And give his side of the story. Was there anything in the press about it?
He didn't set a date. Remember, the last thing we talked about on Friday is that he was promising to come clean.
Oh.
He didn't say when.
Didn't say he was going to do it on Monday.
No.
All right.
Okay. We got a break.
Many lawyers to see before that.
Of course there are. We got an awful lot to get to today. Still got the weekend stuff to get to. Some Lisa Remedy news. Just because we're being petty like that. And we got a brand new game to play today. And shall I tell him, Robbie?
Yeah.
Buzz?
Yeah, I think so.
That later in the show, yes, spotlight on Buzz.
Excellent. Wow.
And especially important, if you happened to be at JCPenney Saturday morning to see Buzz do his live one-man show.
One of the hundreds.
Right, right in front of JCPenney.
We'll
really?
We'll be playing a game.
Let's say yeah.
Okay, I get it.
We'll be playing a game to see how Buzz's gig went. Now a caller 100. Phone number is 877-365-3636. That's the national number.
Very good.
Call now. Dial recklessly. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
I just noticed something that in one of your interviews with John Candy, I believe, it looked like an older interview, you had less hair than you have today. How do you explain that?
I don't wear a wig, sir.
Paint your bald spot?
What bald spot?
You paint your bald spot?
I don't know what you're talking about, sir. My hair grows.
Do you paint your bald spot?
I don't have a bald spot.
How come you had less hair on the tape?
Maybe my hair grew. Maybe I had a bad haircut that day. By the way, something. What do you care?
Paint your bald spot?
I don't. Do you paint your bald spot?
Paint your bald spot?
I'm sick.
The Don and Mike Show.
Sounds like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
They will make your ovaries rock hard. Don and Mike.
Right. My man, L. Kravitz, soon to get into the of N. Kidman.
Pretty good matchup there.
I mean, I'm sure his D has been in her V, but maybe they're going to make it formal.
Yeah.
And boy, would that piss off C. TC.
You know, speaking of TC and that whole union between LK and NC, NK.
Because she's saying to him, I don't need to have the pretty boy movie star with the perfect teeth and Mission Impossible. Why, look, it's Lenny Kravitz. He's a mess.
How about the whole kid thing? When they weren't able to conceive, was that because of Cruise or was that because of Kidman?
Something tells me Lenny can get it done.
I don't doubt that.
Yeah.
Lenny was in our studio one time and received the 4-star award as the most...
the highest guest.
High that we've ever seen.
And that was at 8 o'clock in the morning, and he was so friggin' stoned.
I could lower his sperm count.
Wouldn't it be great if it was Kidman's fault, though, because then... she'd be safe.
Oh, anyway, I'm for the union of Lenny Kravitz, who I'm a big fan of, and Nicole Kidman. I know you're not, Rob. I know you're not, but he's a mulatto, right? Because
no, I think he is 100%. She only played that she was in a mixed marriage
okay.
on the Jefferson.
I was thinking his mom wasn't his mom married to a white guy.
Wasn't his mom Roxy Roker?
Yeah, but,
his mom,
but she was only married to a white guy on TV.
Yeah, his right. real dad isn't Franklin Cover.
Rob's God.
All right, call 100 time. I know you fired him off already. Shut up. Here we go. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Yes, I am caller 100.
Yes, you are, my friend.
All right.
And either way, since the way it's understood is that Tom Cruise dumped Nicole Kidman, Tom Cruise has got to be thinking, just at this bottom guy-to-guy level.
Yeah.
She's dumped a pretty boy for a rocker. A rocker with a past.
But a cool rocker, and a rocker that's, I think,
I mean, it's
no
not like,
stranger to famous ladies, too.
It's not like she dumped Tom Cruise dumped her, and then she hooked up with the lead singer from Smash Mouth. Okay, the guy
exactly.
the guy in the Doritos commercials.
Yeah.
It's not like she dumped him for John Popper.
But the truth of the matter is, when you peel back all the layers,
yes.
you'll understand that Tom Cruise probably wants Lenny Kravitz more than Nicole Kidman does.
And as time has passed, as I've gone back and looked at the Tom Cruise movieography, I've grown more fond of that theory. You know, when you really look at it.
Not a radical theory, incidentally.
No, but I mean really, just based on some of his performances, some of his early work as well. And I think if you really want to...
Look at his new movie, the Samurai movie. I mean,
yeah.
You know, big puffy sleeves, dancing into battle. I realize there's more to it than the way
I base your theory,
characterizing it.
I base your theory only on one movie. Cocktail.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I thought he was very gay in Cocktail. I really do.
And I think, if I'm not mistaken, Tom Cruise is still dating that... I don't know how to say his name. Who's the guy who was the little guy in Jerry Maguire?
Jonathan Lipnicki.
Tom Cruise is still dating him. That affair.
I had no idea that was going on.
What you got to do is remember that movie's like 7 years old now.
Right.
So now.
So Jonathan would be 18 or something.
Johnny.
Wow.
Yeah.
Johnny L. what's your name?
My name's Michael.
Michael, and you are from?
Sacramento, sir.
Right on, KHTK.
Yeah, you bet.
Here you go. Well, you know what that means. No Aerosmith or Kiss tickets.
Well,
I mean, I have a question for you. Are you going to vote tomorrow?
Yes, sir.
And who are you voting for?
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
There you go. Right on.
Good man.
That's right.
Don't let
that's
down.
I bet he's getting a lot of votes in Sacramento.
I wish I could give you the Aerosmith tickets. They're for a local concert. However, you have won the Hunted prize pack.
Right.
That's the movie with Tommy Lee Jones, in-demand pay-per-view from Comcast Cable. And you won the Halloween mask. Hold on. Take it back. The Halloween costume of your choice.
Hey.
Courtesy of Masters Costumes. 7 locations in the D.C. area to find the nearest one. Go to masterscostumes.com. Masters Costumes, a real costume shop. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not going to tell you what to be for Halloween. That's up to you. At this point, I would suggest, and I try to give you the timeliest and most newsworthy suits.
Roy Horn.
Correct, but it's got to be a two-person job. Maybe three, because you're going to need a couple of guys to wear the tiger suit.
Or you could just get a stuffed tiger and just glue it to your throat.
But go all the way with it.
Yeah.
Have the two guys in the tiger suit coming with it. It's a three-man operation if you want to be Roy Horn and Tiger this year.
Blood around their teeth.
Thank you.
If you only have two guys, do the tiger and then get a rag doll and just attach it to the mouth of the head.
All right, thanks.
Thank you
for listening.
All right.
An idea. Go as the tiger.
You're very welcome. All right, thank you.
Roy Horn would be your prop.
Thank you very much.
Horn!
So, and Mike, we're all rooting for the Red Sox tonight, and that's no BS.
Thank you, guys. Yep. I hope they win if they, I know this is hard for people to believe. Even if they don't win, it was a fun weekend. And you know what? And for their home fans, that was a lot of, the only thing I was thinking yesterday is I wish I was there. Because that was like the best party that they've had in 20 years. It was
and,
fun.
Wednesday night, Rob has a prayer.
Yes. Let's root for
while we're rooting for the Sox, let's not forget Horn.
That's right.
The horn.
Sorry, Don. I know I got a little too enthusiastic.
That was from me. That was from Rob. You know, and he tries to hide a gentle giant.
Rob always is the conscience of this.
Well,
show.
They're German.
Right.
Well, you root for the Sox. Don't forget about
Right. Pray for the horn.
Hair horn.
Uh-huh. Hair horn.
Good luck. Good luck. I hope they win. Either way, Wednesday night we'll be paying off the bet that I lost with Mike about the Red Sox.
That's right.
We'll be at the Crystal City Restaurant in beautiful Crystal City, Virginia. We'll be there starting at 8:00 on Wednesday night. Now you're welcome to come down and view myself and Tom Gavin for 1 hour sitting at a table by ourselves with a tape recorder at the Titty Bar.
Please do.
Mike and all the gang will be there. Sadly, and I'd much rather meet you guys than spend time with Tom.
Right.
It's an hour of just Tom and I together.
Yes. The rules for the bet, you will not be able to, and I think we have to modify this because of the nature of the bet. We didn't have to worry about the throngs coming down to Club Wet due to its location.
And in fact, it's a queer bar.
I think we're probably going to have, I've already received a lot of interest in people coming down. And I think really you got to give Don and Tom a pretty wide berth at the Crystal City Restaurant.
But everybody's welcome.
Yeah.
Come on down.
But you're talking about your table. There will be two seats there, and no one is allowed to sit with you.
And I would think you would feel the same way, because the other people could be viewed as Tom Breakers.
Absolutely.
The people are buffering.
Mm-hmm. They're buffers between you and Tom, and you will have to engage Tom in conversation for the entire time.
This is about quality time.
For an hour. Yeah. And
are you going to be buying Tom a drink?
More than one, Mike. Tom's not driving.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'm going to be buying Tom more than one drink.
Very good.
And I've got some roofies.
Oh, no. Going to try to put them in his drink and get them back to your hotel.
So we'll see you Wednesday night at the Crystal City Underground for that at 8 o'clock. And then you'll hear it on
Crystal City Restaurant.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said Crystal City Underground. You're right. Yeah, so we'll see you there Wednesday. You'll hear it on the show Thursday. Rob, you're not going
to
see Tom drive. Rob's not driving my car.
Could we have the ante if they win tonight, if the Red Sox win tonight? Could Tom drive your car?
He's not laughing.
Here's how we could up the ante.
Yeah.
That I would take the Red Sox tonight. Mm-hmm. I think we both, wouldn't it be impossible for Tom to drive either of our cars?
Yeah, I believe so. I don't think he would drive.
But if you wanted to add some Tom foolery to this bet,
Like?
I don't know, like... Either make it worse for me, or you have to do it.
No.
No?
No, no. I earned that bet, believe me.
How about riding a two-man bicycle with Tom?
No.
You can't get a two-man bicycle. It's like on the boardwalk. Never mind. We'll keep it as it is.
I wouldn't mind.
I don't want to
see what happens tonight. If something happens tonight and we go to the ALCS, then I would be willing to, put a bet forward.
Yeah. I lost this one. I'll pay it off. And I'm rooting for the Red Sox.
But you know what? I just want to enjoy it, too.
I'm rooting for the Red Sox.
Thank you.
So I hope it happens for you tonight. Like I said, what a great weekend. I was happy on Friday, and I'm happy today because I had a really good weekend. Our kid was home just long enough for... Now, I'll give you my perspective and my wife's perspective.
Good.
Just long enough for me to really miss him. And for my wife to really be ready for him to go. And there were parts, I mean, she feels like I do, I'm sure, I know, and I feel like she does. It's just, she's got this thing with him, this mothering thing, that she won't let go of.
Can't.
And things were fine all weekend. He got in Friday night, came over, brought the gal pal over. So like I was saying, you saw him Saturday, went to the game, tell you about that. I mean, you saw him on Sunday. Mm-hmm. Sunday he came home, he had about 3 hours before his plane left. Finally got home. He said he would be home anywhere from, 11 a.m. Well, it ended up being 1 o'clock. He comes in, and he's here no longer than 30 minutes in the house, and he's collecting his stuff. When I start to hear the voices from upstairs, just like when he used to live in the house.
The raised voices from upstairs?
The raised voice on both ends.
Yeah.
That it's the tone I know that sets my wife off. The tone, and anybody with a teenage kid knows this tone, where you can say something like, gee, Bart, isn't the weather great today? And what you get back at this level is, Mom, I know the weather is great. Yeah. Then you've heard my wife's lovely voice. Her voice goes up an octave.
Right.
And at some point, only the dogs are hearing this.
They're gathering in the front yard.
Because it's she's saying to him, you've got to do this or you've got to do this. And his response every time is, Mom, stop. So finally, I went upstairs and I said, now I remember what I missed the most about when we were all together.
Right.
When we were all the family. You go to your separate quarters and you go to your separate quarters.
Right.
They didn't have to go to separate quarters. But it was just a weird moment. So yeah. I'm happy that he came home. I'm glad I got to spend some time with him. That boy needs to be off at college. That boy needs to be out of our house.
Did you and your wife commiserate at all after he had finally left?
No.
Was there a moment of peace, or was there still tension?
And no, there was no tension. And don't get me wrong, that I think he's as much to blame for this as she is. That I think, she and I have had these discussions about when he comes home, and more so with me, because I was going through the whole, empty nest thing. That I was really missing him a lot. Now it's just you see him. Mm-hmm. If he goes, he goes. That's kind of what we worked on. All this BS about
you're letting go.
You don't want to be a friend to your kid. I mean, you always want to be a friend, but you want to be a parent first,
right,
and be a friend second. So, at one point after this exchange had been going on, when he was, I do have to rat him out here. He's trying to pack some shirts to bring back to college. And he screams from upstairs, because Frida's downstairs with me, he screams from upstairs, Mom, where's my shirts? Now, she has no idea what shirts he's talking about.
Right.
She goes, what? And he goes, my shirts! Mom, I need my shirts! And at that point, I pulled her over and I said, just remember, this is in an hour from now, our life will go back to being the way that it is now. And had to calm, not that I had to calm her down, but it was just
preventative, really.
Yeah, thanks, Buzz. Yeah. It was nutty, but I liked having him around, and I know she liked having him around, even though he's still...
This will be the next 4 years. You just have little bits of this until graduation, and then he comes back home.
He's still a... No, absolutely not.
You're not going to allow that, huh?
No, he's still a slob. He still has no definition of time or what time he's getting up or anything else. But we had two separate moments through the weekend
that involved him indirectly. We went to this Maryland-Clemson football game. And when we got there, we saw Bart, we saw his girlfriend, we saw some of his friends. Then he went to sit with his friends. He went to sit in the student section. And my wife had tickets for us in the alumni sponsor section.
Right.
Now, we went to a little pre-meal dinner thing. Right. At 1:30 in the afternoon for a 3:30 game. Little food spread on University of Maryland campus, and they had a very nice room and nice food layout and booze.
That's a pretty nice deal.
And well, you got to pay for it.
Oh,
but,
oh sorry.
You know, it was nice. I grant you that. But when you think about that orange jumpsuit, that orange running suit that was given to me by them,
He didn't want you to wear that because he was going to be embarrassed.
So I was very low key. I had on a golf jacket that just had a very small Clemson logo on the pocket.
How much Clemson clothing do you currently own?
A lot.
If you were to give a rough estimate of how many items of Clemson clothing do you own right
now? Maybe 25. So I'm thinking I've played this correctly because my kid has said, Dad, look, don't wear the orange, you know, running
very
suit.
Dignified,
I think when my wife and I walk up and she has her Clemson earrings in, her tiger paw earrings, but she has a necklace, but that's all she's wearing, no jacket, no nothing.
Okay.
We walk into a sea of orange, an absolute sea of orange, and the first thing that the guy says to me is, you're from the Clemson side, right? And I pointed to my, you know, understated logo,
right.
And went, yeah, right there. And he said, that's not Tiger Pride. And I realized
that. How much did that suck?
And I realized when I walked in the room that indeed everybody wears every ridiculous piece of clothing that they've.
And it's a color that your jacket wasn't orange.
No, the jacket was blue.
And they, jacket that's was blue. Not Tiger Pride.
So we leave there and we walk over to the stadium, and on the way to the stadium we're walking with all of the Clemson fans. It was a Maryland game there, so the visitors.
Any heckling?
Yes, and interesting heckling from the Clemson people to the Maryland people.
Hmm.
The Maryland fans are yelling, "You suck! You suck!" You know, because they're drunk,
right?
And the Clemson people are drunk, and the Clemson people, their response was, they pointed to the stadium, Bird Stadium, and all of them, 100 of them together, would scream, "High school stadium! High school stadium!" So at this point, I'm glad that I'm not wearing all orange.
Yeah.
Because
now the Maryland Terrapins got a new field house, right? A new place for the basketball team, but they still don't have the...
They still got the antiquated, you know, it looks like...
What the hell's the name of it? It's a famous name stadium. The Maryland Stadium.
Now it's the Comcast Center.
That's the new one, but what's the football stadium called?
Still called Bird Stadium.
Bird Stadium. That's
called Bird Stadium.
Bird Stadium. Yeah, okay.
So,
high school stadium. That's funny.
And can I just take a second out here to say something else? You know who else has Tiger Pride?
Who?
Roy Horn.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God.
Don't kill the animal. Don't kill the tiger. All right, I'll tell you this one very briefly, and then one more. We get back from the break, then I'm out. So we're sitting up in the stands, my wife and I, along with all of these Clemson fans, many of them like her alumni about our age. And right to my left is a group of guys ranging in age, I say, from 25 to 50.
Okay.
And they're bombed. Everybody's bombed. I'm cool with that.
Are Clemson fans or Maryland fans?
Clemson fans.
Okay.
They're sitting in the Clemson section.
All right.
And these guys, every time that Clemson, on the rare occasion, they would do something correct, these guys would stand up and they would either go with their arms out, just go, T-I-G-E-R-S, Tigers, Tigers, Tigers. Or when they'd make a first down, they'd stand up and go, you know how the referee makes the motion for first down?
Yeah.
These guys would stand up, I'm talking about 10 of them in a section, and go, like to make the tomahawk, going, T-I-G-E-R-S, first down. And you're in a 50,000-seat stadium, and you it's 200 people against 50,000.
Right.
But they were making a pretty large amount of noise, and every time they started doing one of their Tigers, 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 what I did was I screamed, Tar!
cards! Cards! And I mean, I was screaming it and looking right at, the guy was as close to me as microphone number four is.
Did you learn from our little experience at FedEx Field when you, in a stadium environment, you can kind of say anything and they really don't pick up on it?
The guy looked right at me, I swear to you, and he was going, T-I-G-E-R-S! And he said, Tigers, and I looked right at him and I went, Cards! And he gave me the sign like, yeah.
Because he thought you said Tigers.
Yeah.
There you go.
It's a fun thing in a stadium. Your voice just gets absorbed in a stadium. It's a lot of fun.
And Frieda leaned over and said to me, are you having fun? I said, you've not heard? Every time they make the cheer, I yell, Tard! And I point right at them.
Tard.
Tards.
There you go, Tards.
Tards.
And what was the final score? Do you remember? Or do you remember the who won?
Maryland, 1 million. Clemson, another. No, it was 21-7.
21-7?
21-7. Victory, Maryland.
Hmm.
Victory, Maryland.
Well, Maryland's got a pretty good program.
Yeah.
And I proudly, as I walked around, you know, because everybody at one of these games is from somewhere. And there were people, I noticed this as well, and I mentioned to Frieda, I see this sometimes at pro games, but I didn't think he saw this at college games. You expect to see kids wearing Maryland stuff, or Clemson stuff in this case, but there was some guy wearing Notre Dame stuff there, another guy was wearing Nebraska stuff.
Representing their school? Or just like what they got at the pro shop.
Yeah, I don't get it. I don't get
the
why
local
you would.
Dick's Sporting Goods.
It's like you're breaking the cardinal rule. The cardinal, you know, the first cardinal rule is, for instance, if you've got a Cubs baseball hat on, you don't mix and match it with a Red Sox jersey or even, God forbid, a football jersey or jacket.
Yeah, I don't think that's appropriate.
But keep your sports together, and you try to keep your
color
team.
Coordinate your teams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you're going to go to an away game. Or go to a home game that is not the team that you support. Why are you there wearing these colors? So one of the guys who was loud, the Notre Dame fan, was sitting about four rows in front of us. And when I was in the middle of the whole tard thing, one time I went, go Notre Dame! And he caught it.
Uh-huh.
And
oh.
He turned around and he said, Notre Dame!
Of course.
So why was he doing was he one of the guys doing the Tiger chant?
No, he was sitting just in the section, but he heard me say Notre Dame as I was mocking
him. Was he drunk?
Yeah. So he turned around and he went,
now I'm confused.
He went, Notre Dame! I said to him, why are you wearing a Notre Dame jacket and hat?
Good question.
He said, and we're number one!
Well, there you go.
people.
And then I just looked at him, and he said, where'd you graduate? And this is where I lost the argument, because I went, Hard Knocks. And he went, I swear to God, the guy goes, Fort Knox? Hard Knocks. And then I realized that the play has stopped on the field.
And you're having a conversation with him.
I, at one moment, screamed to this guy, I never went to college!
Oh, no.
And I'm sitting in the middle of this section. And to make it worse,
it was broadcast over the PA.
I have stolen one of these little stickers to put on your shirt or your jacket when we were at the alumni dinner.
Oh, right.
I've stolen this little tiger paw that has stitched on it, alumni.
Right. Ah.
So I'm wearing a little patch on my jacket.
Oh, no.
That says alumni. Now, I don't know if anybody caught on to this.
Couldn't he, as the spouse of an alumni, wear it too, maybe?
It wasn't there for me to begin with. And I know I know we were sitting in there enjoying our chicken or whatever we were having. Frieda saw me lift it from the table.
Right.
I know she saw me lift it because it's just one of these things you just peel off the back and you stick it on, and it looks like it came with the jacket. And hell, everybody else had one.
That's right.
Yes. Everybody you else had one.
You cracked me up. It's like you thought maybe you'd get into the VIP area, right, with the sticker?
I don't know. At least, you know, I'm not just some schmuck that's there because my wife went there and my kid goes there.
Right, right.
Yes, I'm an alum.
Not only are you an alumni, but you also bowled a perfect game. Just look at your bowling shirt.
No, Rob, that's 200 game. The patch we stole was for a 200.
There you go.
For
200 game.
It's too long.
That is so funny, though. I didn't go to college. You immediately looked down at your alumni.
Yeah, and I'm sure that in my mind it was overblown, but it seemed to me that, because at a game.
Did you feel the eyes after you did that?
Yeah, and then I just sat down.
Yeah.
Then I just sat down and didn't offer up any more commentary at all. But I got one last thing about getting there, and we got a break. We'll be right back, okay?
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Did I not clearly explain the circle of trust to you, Greg?
Yeah, I think I got it.
Then is there something you want to tell me?
I don't think so.
See, if I can't trust you, Greg, then I have no choice but to put you right back outside the circle. And once you're out, you're out. There's no coming back.
Well, I would definitely like to stay inside the circle.
Well, then tell me the truth.
Jack, I don't know what we're talking about.
All right, now look, Fokker. I'm a patient man. That's what 19 months in a Vietnamese prison camp will do to you. But I will be watching you, studying your every move. And if I find that you are trying to corrupt my firstborn child, I will bring you down, baby. I will bring you down to Chinatown.
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe.
This is Ghetto-licious.
Shut up, fat ass. Here's Don and Mike.
All right, before I tell you about how do I generalize some enterprising Latinos that I had the opportunity to see over the weekend.
Wonderful.
Here is a first for our show with Westwood One. Hmm. That's Westwood One. Right, Westwood One.
Amen.
This is the first contest. We've allegedly been working with this network for 12 years.
Mm-hmm. Very exciting, though.
And we really are working with them now, and here's a contest. Value $3,500. Hmm. Win a trip to the premiere of Matrix Revolutions in Los Angeles. Ooh. Now, it's a national contest because we are a national show.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So there are no other radio stations, no other Westwood One, jerk faces involved in this. However, because it is Westwood One, here's how we're giving this trip away.
Okay.
Call 1-888. Let me... What's wrong with the telephones?
Sounds fine to me.
I'm getting nothing there. Let me try this bank.
Is the computer sleeping again?
Hold on a second.
Oh, you have to bring that up. You have to bring up that thing.
Wish we had an engineer here today.
Or any day.
Jesus. Well, I can't even dial this damn thing up, can I?
You can't win anyway.
Well, I know I can't win, but I'm just trying to explain it here, Robbie.
Oh, okay.
Working great, Beav.
Okay, this is how the digital lines sound. Hold on a second. There you go.
You know, maybe we're not going to have another contest for 12 years after this. I don't know.
Well, I want to call to demonstrate, but you'll do this on your own. You call 1-888-898-6402.
Okay.
And you have to listen to about a 30-second spiel about what you'll win.
Uh-huh.
And then you leave your name and your phone number.
Okay.
And that's it. Contest ends next Monday. One person out of all of the people who call in...
We'll call them?
Yeah, we will call them.
And they'll be the big winner.
They'll get the trip to Los Angeles for the Matrix Revolutions. And then, let me see, the 20 people after that get the Matrix Reloaded DVD.
Very good.
But you must call because it's Westwood One. You know, God bless them, and they're working with us now. They're really...
Yes, they are. And this is a great, great prize. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I even got, and I've been told not to say anything, so I won't, but I'll tell you, I even got an email today about some market clearances that maybe they're working on. Let me just toss out one to you, Mike.
Well, there's only one that really means a lot to me.
And I know, and I'm not supposed to say anything. But let me just say, if you call members of your family who live in the greater Toledo, Ohio area...
Hey, Butthead!
Finally.
My dreams have come true.
I know I wasn't supposed to say anything. I hope I haven't soured the milk on that. Westwood One, they're a great network. We're a part of their network. This is a Westwood One contest. So
I think we could go to the Jamie Farr Museum.
rather than give us the prize, I think what they're trying to... I really believe that this is some type of test. This is some type of test.
Where we're being measured?
Yes, where we're being measured, where you guys are being measured.
What's the number again? Let's make sure people respond.
We've made it much easier, Mike. Just go to WJFK.com.
Ah,
much better.
And click on the icon for Don and Mike Show, and it'll give you the phone number there.
Very good.
I mean, I realize it's an added step, but why go through the hassle of waiting to hear, you know, anyway.
Try to write it down.
It's 888-898-6402.
Mm-hmm.
No sales, shill bit, just a 30-second solicit. All you do is leave your information, and for those of you with no life, and that's about all of you, because you're listening to the show right now.
We're going
to
find out how we're doing with the phone calls.
And we thank you.
Because, you know, we're being measured.
You can call as often as you like.
Very good.
To win. There is no limit. There is no limit. I get it, Buzz. I get jokes. There is no limit on the number of times you can call this.
Oh, my God.
Better luck than
we're getting closer, though. Listen, there was some dial tone there.
Yeah.
And now it's
Jesus.
And now it's gone.
Jesus.
All right, now here's someone saying that the number doesn't work.
Yeah,
well,
okay.
I called it no before problem. The show today. Hello?
Yeah, Don, it's not working.
I mean, no, I called it before the show.
I just called.
Trust me.
Yeah, all right, I'll trust you.
That module needs to be reseated. Wendell told me how to fix it. We can do it in the next break.
All right, hold on a second.
All right, Don is now calling the number to see if indeed the phone number doesn't work.
898-6402.
I think we started the new relationship with Westwood One beautifully.
I think so.
All right, here we go.
Let's see.
888-898-6402.
Well, it's ringing.
This is not a gag.
Are you kidding me?
I'm not.
You didn't. Hello?
No, I had to hang up because it was not.
They didn't have
it was
give permission.
It was a foreign accent.
Hold on a second.
Hello.
That was the 888 number.
I swear to Christ.
He was Takimaki Beachside.
You want to win?
Hello.
Oh, man.
That's the Matrix.
I swear I sat in the office and called this before we went on the air today.
You did and you got through?
Yes.
Worked fine.
So that's
all right, this is a problem.
Now, perhaps
this is a problem.
I'm not using the digital phone.
No, I don't think it's a problem.
Rob, can you try it on? Well, it doesn't matter if you try it on that line.
Well, I can try it on. Yeah, I can do it here. Hold on.
No, but if you call it there, I can't put the call on the air.
No, but I'll tell you who we get.
Rob's going to call it off the air now
to see if he gets through
another test.
Let's see if Rob gets a lady speaking in French now. Rob's using the hard.
We've got a real problem if that's the number they're using.
Naturally.
What? Is it busy?
It's busy. Let me try once more.
It's busy? Okay.
Have we given out the right number?
Yes. 1-888-898-6402.
I've already memorized.
Busy. Somebody's getting through.
Of course.
That's a good sign. It's busy.
Well, somebody might be getting through speaking to a French woman.
Well, I believe that problem was probably something. This is way too confusing to explain. We have digital phones. We have analog phones. Mm-hmm. The digital phones are down. We're on the analog phones. You can't dial out on the analog phones. You can only dial out on the digital phone.
Gotcha. So that might be redirecting your phone call to a different number.
I don't know. Here's a guy who says he got through fine.
Oh, good.
Scott.
Yeah, I got through with no problem.
All right, what did it say?
It just prompted you, giving you the whole spiel about winning a DVD and everything else, and then you leave your name, age, and telephone number, and that was it.
All right.
Bingo.
Thank you.
That's it. Well, and obviously, if Rob's getting a busy signal, lots of people are calling.
Good.
And now Rob has got out a big, gigantic Pee Wee Herman-sized screwdriver. And Rob's going to attempt to manually reset the telephones.
While everybody else is calling 888-898-6402.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
I couldn't get through on it, man.
Well, did you get a busy signal or something wrong?
It says the number, your call did not go through. Gives me that little tone thing, and then your call did not go through.
What number did you dial?
The number you gave, 898-6402.
Mm-hmm. What was the first three numbers?
888.
And what was the number before that?
1.
Okay, what's the number I'm thinking of right now?
6.
Oh, sorry. Wrong.
Very good. I didn't trust that last one.
Ow!
God.
You know, if this is the phone bank that I used to call out on.
Yeah. Use that phone book to call the audiologist.
Phone
after
bank.
The show, because I'm going back in.
A problem. Today.
I'm going to go back in and see her.
You heard that okay, right?
What? Yeah, it's okay for all you guys with good hearing. So.
Do you have any idea what you're doing down there?
Ta-da!
So that way you took out two screws?
Yeah, these are the these are the.
What was he doing under the console?
Just helping out Don.
Helping out Don. That's usually a Monday tradition, isn't it? So Monday's the only day you allow that to happen.
Need some release.
After the Ted's weekend.
Not that, Ned, listen, but not that I didn't. I want to say, I know it oogies you out when I bring this up, but I'm going to bring it up.
It's only when you go into ridiculous detail.
Because we have a moment here. I will tell you that I laid the pipe to my wife on Saturday night, and I am not exaggerating. I'm going to try to call her. She won't want to talk about it, but I want to tell you. And I clocked myself 8 solid minutes.
Wow.
Of a woman on man love before I could wait no longer.
Yeah, that'll get longer.
Now, if 8 to 10 minutes, I say to any woman, if you can't get it done in 8 to 10 minutes, honey, you got to find yourself a new oven to cook in, because
honey,
is that a new record for you?
No, I think I've done better. Mm-hmm. I think I've done better, but in recent times.
You can have a couple of toddies, it'll make it last even longer.
And it was one of those things where we were done, and I was just, but I said nothing to her, like, hey, how about, look at that. Hey, good job, Rob.
Way to go, Rob.
Thank you. All right, now we can try 1-888-898-6402. I was actually proud of myself with my wife.
Was
busy.
Very popular.
I was actually proud of myself. I thought, well, look, I got this job done.
Sure.
I'm doing the work.
That's good.
I'm baby stepping.
Yeah, that wasn't too much detail.
Well, normally it's very brief, Mike. And I'm not telling you how I laid there afterwards, naked, alone in my bed with just my socks on.
Okay.
My wife was long gone.
All right.
And meanwhile.
Jesus. That's the second time I've said Jesus.
Meanwhile, even though the act was done, I was somehow still strangely aroused. Hi, sweetie.
Hi, handsome.
I was just talking about...
Your wife called you handsome.
You know, we've not mentioned that sex Saturday night.
Yeah, but let's keep it that way.
Okay. Not bad, though. That's all I had to say. Not bad.
And still no experiment?
No.
Mm.
No. No time to take your pills,
No, and I suggested the experiment, but the experiment, unfortunately, takes too much. Forethought.
Well, here's the thing. Because let's say it takes an hour for the pill to work, and we don't know.
How long in an empty stomach?
Buzz gave Frida some Viagra.
Yeah, but Buzz, I know it's like a couple hours if you eat, but I was hungry, so I thought it would be a good time to try.
On an empty stomach, maybe 20, 25 minutes for it to kick in. If you chew it, it's bitter, but it kicks in fast.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Rush.
Here's the thing. All I wanted to do was just get it on. I wouldn't mind some night if I come home from work, as long as it's not a Sunday night or a Monday night when there's football on. When I come home from work, if she said, hey, I took the pill at 7, I'm ready right now.
Right.
But for some reason, it was now going on 10 o'clock on Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
We decide that we're going to try this, and she says, well, wait, hold on, let me take my pill. And I said, well, if you take Buzz's, Viagra, well, gosh, it's going to be an hour, and an hour from now, I'm going to be asleep. I said, come on, never mind. I said, Dad, do it tomorrow.
Rely on your wife to, like, get the timing right.
I got to plan it better.
I said, never mind. Take the pill tomorrow. And then she finally relented. She said,
you know what you should do, Freddie? You should take the pill and not tell him.
Right. But, and darling, that would work because you're pretty much, as long as football's not on, you're always available. Is that right?
That's
right.
That's right. There you go.
Smart the way I've caught on after 22 years. That's the way it is.
So, I only said that just while they were filling the thing here, getting the thing fixed. Now that I can talk to you about what I really want to talk to you about, we're on our way to this football game, this college football game, and we're driving on University Boulevard.
Right.
Route 29 or?
I think I don't know.
Maybe it's no route number.
Right? It's a major artery.
And it's a way to get to the University of Maryland to go to this game. And we were going through a neighborhood that...
Infinity Road.
Oh, I see you've been there, Rob.
a neighborhood where the majority of the signs are not in English. They're in Espanol.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, frankly, we were enjoying our bumper-to-bumper drive down Route 20. I keep wanting to call it Route 29. It's University Boulevard. It's major league crowded because it's a big football game. Mm-hmm. There are four lanes of traffic each way going through strip mall areas.
Okay.
So we're not going very fast. Like five cars are getting through a light when you get to Best Buy and Circuit City. And I'm not exaggerating when I said there are taco stands on every corner. And
well, it wasn't just, I mean, there was pretty much, it was an international lane, I would say.
So we get to the point where there's more of a backup than we've been used to, and we notice that there are two Latino fellows behind the car. They're out of the car, they're behind, and there's a guy behind the wheel. Well, it's obvious the car has stalled.
Okay.
Now, this is a four lane road. There's a Sam's Club on the right, and there's like a big CVS right in on the left. There are stoplights, right hand turn signal, left hand turn, everything. These guys are in the right hand lane, and they're pushing the car. Now, because we're in stop and go traffic, they're able to get away with this because, like I said, the cycle of the lights is maybe only five cars get through because it's
traffic's
so,
crawling.
So right. Jam packed going to the stadium. These guys are in the right hand lane, and there's They had a perfect spot to pull off onto the access road
right. And
get their car in front of the Safeway or whatever it was. We're behind them in traffic, and we're watching this, and I said to Frida, I don't believe this. These guys are moving to the left.
Oh, no.
Now, they could have gotten off this major road.
Mm-hmm.
What they did was the driver put his hand out the window, his left hand out the window to indicate he was turning left, and through the next 15 minutes... These guys pushed the car.
He was trying to merge?
Yeah, we
just from the fourth lane. It's a four lane all
fourth
going.
Fourth lane on the right all the way over to the left?
Yeah. Over the fourth lane, third
gotta
lane.
Gotta say it again. Jesus.
So he's going all the way over.
I'm sure that helped traffic.
And we're thinking, well, they want to go to maybe, I thought, well, maybe there's some kind of car repair shop on the left-hand side. They had to get over
there.
Yeah,
that's what I would think.
So they get up to the point where you can make a left-hand turn into this other strip mall shopping area. They pass up the left turn, and they push the car through the intersection.
Oh, no.
The whole time continuing in the left-hand lane.
They're just doing their Saturday errands. Why?
And the thing is, when the car...
So obviously thinking perhaps... Up ahead, there's another left turn they want to take.
Well, now, here's the problem. University Boulevard, the stretch that we're on, it's rather hilly. So when the guy gets to a spot where they have to stop the car, the driver has to put on the parking brake.
Oh, wow.
The two guys who are behind the car, they go running through traffic across three lanes or one lane, whatever it is, to get to the median where they stand and smoke cigarettes until the light turns green. Then when the light turns green... They go running back behind the guy's car. The guy releases the parking brake. They've got to do the get the motion going, mm-hmm. where you get a little bit of momentum behind you.
Get it rolling.
One, two, three, and then the two guys start to push this car, and they're pushing and pushing, and two cars get through the light, and it's red again. And the guy inside beep, honks the horn, turns on the parking brake. Two guys behind him. I mean, wow. I have Frida on the phone because I've been accused of exaggerating. This went on for 20 minutes.
Oh, well, it was, you know, but to be honest, the truth was stop and go. It was a very convenient way to do your errands. They really, you know, they didn't hold up traffic once they, the weaving was made it a little difficult. But otherwise, it was as if, you know, Fred Flintstone was driving his car with his
No, that's
feet.
When your car basically becomes no longer a mode of transportation, but basically a storage facility for stuff that you might acquire when you're out shopping.
Right. There's, so no, we, there's no reason just to let the lack of a motor stop you from running your Saturday.
It's Saturday.
No, and then, you know, when we were leaving the game, garbage and trash and excrement.
Excrement?
Yeah.
Human?
As we were leaving, I couldn't tell them. I couldn't do the test.
But, couldn't taste it.
The other thing that we couldn't figure out, we've never seen this before. When leaving the game, we left at halftime. Clemson was getting killed, and our kid wasn't sitting with us, and right. It was raining, and it was, yeah, let's get out of here. We're leaving. There are still people in the...
Hey, Sugar Bart's on the other line. Hold on.
There are still people in the parking lot who are tailgating. Now, these are people who have a DirecTV satellite on the roof of their Econo van.
Right.
Now, I asked some of them. They never had tickets to the game. They never wanted to go inside to go to the game. They just wanted to come to the parking lot and sit in the parking lot and watch the game.
Wow.
Hello?
And she had to go.
She hung up.
This is not... This
watch the game on television.
This is not confined to college ball. There's a guy who was at every Redskins game last year. You know where the church is?
Yeah.
You know, praise the Lord.
I got news for you. It's not confined to games. It can be really? Done at concerts, too.
But why? In all cases, why would you go?
I did it at a concert.
For what concert?
Dave Matthews.
Yeah, but you were there just to party and then get out, right?
No. I had tickets. I just didn't go in.
Okay, all right, but even
I mean, I went,
I'll
I
cut
went.
You slack because you went with the intention of going to the concert.
And just decided
you met some friends, you started a party.
Yeah.
These people had no tickets.
So they just go and roost there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But let me explain this. When I did this, and I know it just happened that I didn't go, that I could have gone if I wanted to, but when I did that, the only thought I had was, for big concerts that are really tailgate-oriented, like Dave Matthews, it's something that really I would entertain doing just for a social activity.
Sure.
Because, and it would be the same
thing. Well, you found your element then, because we saw these
it's
people.
It's just a great party. I mean, the game, I've gone to many sporting events
but
where
here's the, thing.
The game is just a pain in the ass. Right.
So these people are a mile away from the stadium in a concrete parking lot.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And when I say some of the people.
Sorry, Daddy-O.
That's okay. Some of the tailgaters were in a parking garage. I mean, not outside, not by the field.
Well, now that doesn't make sense.
In a parking garage where they had the hibachi set out.
Right.
And they had the chairs set out.
Do you understand what, in my opinion, is the when we went to the game on that Thursday night, the best part of the drive over there, we were having a great time. It was very festive immediately prior to the game. When we got into the game, we had a few moments, but, you know, we left, what, the third quarter?
Right.
You know, and it's just the getting into the stadium, getting out of the stadium.
Well,
that's like a giant hassle.
I can't figure it out.
The fun part really is like it's like Green Bay. What's the fun part? It's putting the brats out on the little grill.
I don't know. They're squatters. That's all.
That's right. You didn't like the people that just did it without any intention of
going
to the game.
We saw them when we were leaving at halftime, and I mean it was cold and raw and raining, and we're leaving, and they've got all their their terrapin. Tense up, and
I have always observed
the satellite dish
that major sporting events are simply a facilitator for festivity.
Right,
and yes, Robert
agrees.
Honey, we got a break, but you'll back me up on the Latino gentleman on University Boulevard.
Yes, you don't exaggerate. That was the absolute truth.
There you go.
See, did you ever? Was he in your rearview mirror by the time you ever figured out what he was doing?
Nah, he had moved. I had moved all the way over to the right lane by that time. We just passed him up, and people were honking.
So you never knew how the date ended. Like
no.
their errand running.
Love to know.
We did not. And what did the boy want? Can you tell us on the young?
The boy he's coming home a week from Thursday. I think he's got fall break, so we'll see him again.
Fall break.
There you go.
Thursday. Okay.
That's good.
All right. He was just calling with reports of grades and stuff like that. You know, it was the I'm bored, I'm walking, I'll call mom call. That I get all the only day. And then it's, gotta go, somebody interesting, you know.
You were going to get that call for years, though, rest assured.
Yeah, well, I give them to my mom. I'm bored, I got nothing
That's
to do.
That's when I call my mom.
There you go.
Yeah. You know, it's like, hey, there's nothing going on, I think I'll call mom.
Yeah, it's like servicing the mom account.
It is, exactly.
All right, baby, I'll see you later.
All right, love you.
All right, love
and
you.
If I can very briefly mention one thing about my kid, my oldest daughter, Catherine, got her very first base hit in Machine Pitch Little League, 8 years old, and she knocked one to right field and got a base hit. One of only two girls on the team. She's my little tomboy, and she's doing great in baseball. Absolutely.
There you go.
But they still don't get into the Red Sox. I tried to get them into the game, and they don't. You know, it's like, Daddy, we want to go finish watching our movie. I'm like, okay, bye-bye. You know, but it was great. It was
Hello, wonderful. Don and Mike, congratulations to her.
Yes, way to go, Catherine.
Very cool.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah.
Hey, Don and Mike, I was calling to let you all know that I called the Matrix number a few minutes ago, and something really funny happened. I got through to somebody at Westwood One. If you wait online after you give your information, they give you a chance to dial another lady comes on and gives you a chance to dial a 4-digit or 5-digit access code. You dial just type in some numbers, and you can actually talk to somebody over at Westwood One.
And what did you talk to some? Now, this to us is new territory. We've never done a promotion with Westwood One. This is a great prize.
Yes, it is.
Trip to Los Angeles for the Matrix Revolutions. What did the Westwood One affiliates person say to you?
All I told them was I was calling from Lafayette, Louisiana, and I told my name, and they said, "How did you get this number?" I said, "I just typed in the code after the contest." He said, "What contest?" I said, "The contest for the Matrix." He said, "The Matrix?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "The one that's on the Don and Mike show." He said, "Don and Mike?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "They gave this number?" I said, "Yeah, they gave me the number, but I dialed."
Slow down. Okay. What do you mean access code?
Once you call the Matrix number, you wait a second. And
my friend, did you say you're calling from Louisiana?
Yeah.
All right, you know, we're going to have to take a quick break, bring ourselves down, readjust to get ourselves on the level where we can understand what you're saying.
I understand him.
Do you?
I do.
What was he saying, Buzz?
I think that Westwood One is using their voicemail system, and simply by staying on the line and entering a random extension number, you get to talk to somebody.
That's correct.
And now everybody knows that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. All right.
It was just pretty funny.
So what did the Westwood One person say to you?
They basically wanted to know how I got the number. And I told them I had heard the number on Don and Mike. And the person didn't know what Don and Mike was.
So you're saying the number we're giving out is voicemail?
Well, no, I think they're using their voicemail system for this promotion. If you stay on the line long enough,
enter
four digits or three or whatever it is they use, you're going to talk to somebody at their desk.
When I called it in the office, it said, "Hi, thank you for calling the Matrix contest. At the beep, we'll ask you for your age, your address, and a phone number where you can be reached. You must be 18 to win this contest. 20 people win the DV. One person wins the trip. Good luck. Leave your information at the tone. Speak slowly." Beep. When I heard that up in the office, that's when I hung up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. If you stay on the line, though, something else will happen?
That's what he's saying, I guess.
Perhaps.
Welcome to our first network contest. Takes our listeners about 2 seconds to figure it out.
Well.
Yeah, we got great listeners. We can,
all right, we'll find out right now. Eight, 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 nine, eight, six, four, oh, two. All right. Well, after all you humps get done calling, we'll call.
I can't believe you didn't answer the right way.
What's that?
Hello, Newman.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Hey, be careful with that. That's the most powerful trank gun on the market.
Huh,
got her in Mexico.
Cool.
Yeah, it is cool. They say it can puncture the skin of a rhino from a...
Ow! Yes! That's awesome!
What?
You just took one in the jugular, man. Yes!
Is this bad?
You should pull that out.
Wait. Pull what out?
The dart, man. Got a dart in your neck.
You're crazy, man. You're crazy. I like you. I'm so tired.
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-265-3636. They're ready to believe you.
So crazy someplace else. We're all stocked up here.
Like two pornographic Imagineers, Don and Mike.
Hey, right. All right, hold on. Not this time. We'll try it really now. 888-898-640.
Checking on our big contest line.
Yep, still busy. Anyway, that's the Westwood One contest. A thought on that, and we'll play a new game here in just a second. Can I be petty about Leah Remedy for 1 second?
Go right ahead.
Please. Excuse me, Lisa Remedy. Was in the car on Saturday night,
I'll get right to the point on this. That's not the point. The point is in the car on Saturday night and turned the radio on and they were playing the replay of our shows.
Right.
Some of the best stuff, according to somebody back there. And about 7 o'clock on Saturday night, I was in the car and heard the part where we had Leo on the telephone. And generally speaking, when I hear us on the air, I just go, and turn it off.
Right.
This was something I listened to. I re-listened to us going at it with Leah, mm-hmm. me going at her in my way, you as always trying to be the mediator occasionally.
Uh-huh. Not being the mediator.
Getting dragged in, right, saying, well, Angelo's dumb. And I was listening to this, and I was thinking, now if I'm a listener, I'm going to like this.
Uh-huh.
Because here's two disc jockeys, regardless if we're big, fat, stupid, dumb, don't know anything, doesn't matter. She's a TV star.
Right.
And she's arguing about the fact that we're busting her balls about the fact that she put her wedding on TV
right.
3 days before the beginning of her television show, before the season opener of her TV show in the new time slot. And the one thing that I retained was, wow, I thought it was great. I would have listened to it if I was driving down the road.
Good, sure. Good.
It was very feisty.
Then I listened to Me More Than You really needling her about, Leah, you had to know, the show airs Sunday night at 10 o'clock on VH1. You're known from being on King of Queens. It was a way of promoting the fact that the new season of King of Queens starts just 3 days later. She said, over and over, nothing could be further. She never mentioned King of Queens, and I believe her quote was, I've got the syndication money now.
Yes.
If all of our fans turned away in droves, I would be fine if King of Queens went off the air.
Right. Mm-hmm. That, yeah, I remember her saying that.
That's how she shut me down, because I was pushing her on that. And in essence, what she's saying is, the VH1 show running 2 days before the King of Queens show
was not related to her show.
Not related.
Show. Right.
And that she doesn't care about publicizing it, and it doesn't matter, because as she said, she's got her syndication money.
Right.
So last night, I'm looking around on the web, and I go to LeahRemini.com,
mm-hmm.
and she's updated her news.
Ah.
Hi. I'm reading right from LeahRemini.com. I know some of you have been asking for wedding pictures. Here's the deal. We didn't take a whole lot of pictures because we had a photographer there from In Style magazine.
Ah.
They tell me it will be coming out in February. King of Queens news. Well, we aired in our new time slot last week, October 1st, Wednesday,
mm-hmm.
and we did great. Thank you. I can't tell you all how the crew, the producers, and the cast were so happy that our fans have followed us. We all celebrated on Thursday. CBS had the highest ratings on a Wednesday night since, like, 1993. So thank you. VH1. We did great there, too. It was the highest-rated show for VH1 for the week. I'm so glad you like that. It was fun to do, and we hope to do more. Much love, Leah.
Okay.
Now, let me read this today to say, this does not sound like a woman who, a week ago, was claiming to be unplugged into the fact that the VH1 show was feeding the King of Queens, and all I really want her to do is just be honest. She was doing something.
I think I understand what you're saying. Well, your mm-hmm. point is that don't pretend you're above ratings and doing things to promote. You know, when you're obviously from that newsletter, you're very plugged into what's
going
on. And
right? There's nothing wrong.
And there's nothing wrong with it. We are very plugged into what's going on. And
everybody does it.
We do things for ratings, too. That's the way everybody works.
What I didn't appreciate was her giving us lip about that. And, you know, it was me more than you because I was pushing her on it. But then I get this stuff. Please, we celebrated on Thursday. CBS had the highest ratings on a Wednesday night since, like, 1993. Well, that's a relative term. I mean, they could have had their highest rated Wednesday night, which means they still didn't beat the other channels.
Right.
But regardless, they had a party.
Mm-hmm.
They had a party.
They had a celebration.
And she notes that the VH1 show was the highest rated show of the week for VH1.
We just want her to say she cares.
So obviously, this girl knows what's going on. But anyway, that's the story of Lisa Remini.
Very good.
Now, I'm going to try this thing one more time, the Westwood One thing.
Hold on.
Let's hope it works. 1-888.
I've been trying and trying and trying.
898-6402. This is our first.
Still busy.
Hold on.
Sometimes you just gotta hit speed. Do we have speed dialed? Or is that just for people who call this show?
No, wait a minute.
Got it.
Okay.
Sometimes if you know, keep calling it, that's how you get through. And obviously a lot of people are trying to do it.
888-698-6402.
All right.
Now it rings.
Good. Excellent.
For goodness sakes.
Thank you for calling the CBS Matrix Contest Line.
The Westwood One, wouldn't it?
Well, thank you for calling the Westwood One Concert Line.
Corrects itself.
If you want to participate in the contest, wait for the beep, and I'm not feeling well.
Oh, no.
And leave your name and your phone number and your age. Beep.
Hey, this is I don't think I'm eligible. I'm Don.
If you like ice cream, hit one. If you like pizza, I like ice cream too. I like pizza too. I like chocolate too. I like Disney Channel too. Who's on the other line? Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Why did you make me do Charlie today? Hello.
When I asked you during the break, you didn't say that you couldn't do it today.
I never said I can't do it. Hi, Don.
Okay, Charlie. We'll tell you later.
Don, I'm dying.
Okay,
oh,
bye,
dear.
Bye, Charlie.
Charlie's ill again.
I think the more that Mike goes out and celebrates the Boston Red Sox, mm-hmm. the worse Charlie sounds.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. Yeah. My God.
You know,
wow.
You seemed okay.
I am
during,
fine.
During the
I'm
break?
I haven't been fine for Charlie in months.
I said to you during the break, how about...
Help me, Don! I thought I could do it.
We'll do the fun. Charlie bit, and you said it back in the Charlie voice.
Hello!
Dear.
I don't like that.
I know you don't. Poor Charlie. I think I do. Oh, my God.
Wow, that didn't...
Charlie took that new job for the medicine.
Have you had that checked out, or is that still that acid reflux
thing? That might be the acid reflux thing, but I who knows?
Anyway.
Who knows? Yeah. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
It's just, it's age, I think.
As far as we can tell, this Westwood One thing is legit. Now,
mm-hmm.
Moving on with what I think could be a great new bit for the show.
Mm-hmm.
Here's how we play. Well, first off, it's called...
That's always a good sign, that music.
Can you hear me now?
All right.
Has everybody seen that dumb commercial with the guy, can you hear me now?
Right.
So, you got to have a cell phone to play the game. And we're going to have to try to take you on your honor at some of this, although it should be easy to prove where you are. Give me a second to explain this. You go to a public place. A restaurant, a fast food place.
Okay.
If you have real balls, a library.
Mm-hmm.
If you have real gigantic balls, a movie theater with a movie in progress.
Right.
But it would work no matter where you're standing. And here's the deal. You're standing in the middle of a large public area.
I'm laughing already.
Yeah. And you have to repeat whatever we say to you at a very loud rate. So if we said to you, my hemorrhoids are killing me. If you were standing waiting for a train in a group of people, you would have to say as loudly as you can, man, my hemorrhoids are killing me.
Right.
And then right there you would win $10.
Wow.
If you can get through 10 of them, and we'll all be able to chime in just with whatever we're thinking at the moment.
I'm gay.
Okay. You don't have to play the gay card.
Right.
But when you get near the $100 range, you might want to look at, for instance, I'll play it too. You look at a guy. God, you're beautiful.
Exactly. Are there men around you, sir? Tell him he's beautiful.
No. It could be anything. It could be my pants are on fire, you could look at a guy, we could have you say to a guy, nice balls! I mean, whatever.
Yes.
The name of the game is Can You Hear Me Now?
And it has to be loud.
And you have to be in a very, very
public place.
And we will ask you questions about the place to verify exactly where you are.
And we also, we should be able to get the ambiance if you're in a train station, a subway station, if you're in a fast food place. The crap detectors will be out, but you'll have 10.
Where would be a crowded place right now, say on the East Coast at this time of day?
Well,
where would be a nice crowded location?
No matter, listen, you never go wrong. At a McDonald's.
You never go wrong. I was thinking right. that. A fast food place would be perfect.
There's always people at McDonald's. There's always people, no matter where you're calling from in the country, at a Target.
Right.
There's always people I think there. I have food poisoning.
Well, now you get why this could be so good.
Yes.
And I want to say this, that we are also, depending on the location you're calling from, there is the chance that we'll elevate the payoff for each one of our 10 things that we ask you to say.
Very good.
For instance, listen, you proved to us you're in a movie theater. Additionally, you're going to double your money right away.
Yeah, and if you make that clear, and we really believe it, and we can tell, we'll give you more money.
And I'm writing notes thinking about this. Okay, what would be the... Well, okay, yeah. Okay, you're at a funeral. Mm-hmm. If you happen to be at a funeral, you might play for 10 times the amount of money.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But I think most people will play it the pedestrian way. They'll go to the shopping centers,
exactly.
Fast food place. Mm-hmm. So, as Rick Dees would say, come milk the dynamite cash cow.
Yeah!
Because we're going to play.
Yeah.
Charlie, poor Charlie.
Sorry, Don.
That's all right, Mike.
Yeah.
We're going to play Can You Hear Me Now?
Uh-huh.
So if everybody's got the prep. Oh, look at this. People already want to play.
I'll be fine after October.
People already want to play. Let me just check with somebody here. Tom?
Yeah.
Now, you want to play this game. Can You Hear Me Now? Here's the question. Where are you planning on being when we give you
I'm in it. I'm there.
Where are you at?
I'm at the Manassas Library.
Okay, now we'll have to verify that. There has to be some way to verify. See,
your library is
this is where the
silent. There's no noise in the background.
The crap detector comes into play. How are you able to get to a library so fast? We started talking about this 2.5 minutes ago.
I live by it.
I don't buy it.
Okay, see, and that's why we have the crap detector.
Mm-hmm.
Lisa.
You know, incidentally, a library sounds exactly like your den.
That's right.
Hello, Lisa.
Hi.
Hi, you want to play too?
Yes.
Where are you at right now, honey?
I'm standing in front of my soon-to-be daughter-in-law's apartment building, and it's like all black here.
It's all, well, no. Gosh, wouldn't that be great to have you drop some N-bombs out there to win some cash? Sorry.
God, help me with the spelling on my tombstone.
Now, Rob, I know you're dying for that. I had to try to turn that lady down. I'm here at my and it's all black.
Isn't that great?
He was excited.
It's all black.
Isn't that great? Duh.
It's like all black, is what she said.
It's all black. Hey, okay, now, first thing you say, come here, boy.
Yeah, right. See how that works.
Come here, boy. How about this? Rush was right.
Yeah.
Rush. No. So we'll go through these calls and we'll find somebody to
We'll help people along, Don.
Get to play this game. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, I'm registered in this class.
What class?
This is U.S. history. See the globe right there.
Really?
Hey. Can I come in?
Oh, please. I get so lonely when I hear that third attendance bell ring and all my kids are not here.
Sorry I'm late. It's just like this new schedule's totally confusing. Yeah, I know that, dude.
Mr. Spicoli.
That's the name they gave me.
Hey, you're ripping my car.
Yeah. Hey, bud, what's your problem?
No problem at all. I think you know where the front office is.
You dick!
The Don and Mike Show.
All right, you dick.
Good evening, gentlepersons. Here's Don and Mike.
Let's see, the cities we broadcast to. Here's your winners. Buffalo yesterday. Way to go, WBUF. That was overtime with the Bengals.
Good win for Buffalo.
They won. Yeah, hey there, Green Bay. I didn't pick you, but you killed Seattle.
Those Packers.
That was sweet. Let me see. San Francisco beat Detroit. I had that as my all-time, like, forget it.
Right.
Throw out everything.
Bet
on Detroit. San Francisco won. Pittsburgh lost last night to Cleveland. If you listen to us, Louisiana. Saints lost again, no surprise. Redskins lost the Eagles.
You knew that was going to happen. Ravens were up. Oh, and the Oakland Raiders got beat by the Bears.
Ravens win?
Ravens were off.
They were off.
No. Ravens were off. Raiders
I didn't
got...
know what you said. I didn't hear what you said.
What?
I just trailed off and I mumbled like I do sometimes. That's what I do.
The Raiders lost to the awful Chicago Bears on the last play of the game. Wow. And the Ravens, the Bears have that kicker, that guy that turns around backwards all the way and like does a little dance when he turns around to kick. His name is Paul Edinger.
He still kicks soccer style though, right?
Yeah,
is it soccer style or is it looks like
it's nothing like you've seen anybody else. When he lines up for a kick, he lines up with his back to the goalpost. He does that thing where they mark out their territory. They take 1, 2, 3 steps, and he actually turns around like this, so he's not looking at where he's kicking.
Wow!
And then they hike the ball, then he turns around and right down the middle and goodbye, Oak.
And what's the deal with the Raiders? Weren't they in the Super Bowl last year?
They suck.
Wow.
They suck.
How quickly they turn around.
All right, here we go. Oh, we'll have our complete fantasy recap tomorrow and also the recap of the picking with Nancy.
Yes.
And tomorrow, Buzz's birthday nude.
Ah.
Oh, that's going to be fun tomorrow. Also tomorrow, we're playing Match Game 2003 on the show.
And very good.
Boy is very excited. Rob has gone on eBay. Rob, you know, we're pressed for time. Let's save it till tomorrow. Okay. Anyway, Rob has a real piece of Match Game history that he'll be using on the show tomorrow when we play Match Game 2003.
Oh, my.
at some point, I'm feeling good about the show because every day there's more stuff that I want to get to that we're not able to get to. We never pushed Mike in a corner today about the Bachelor contest.
No, I thought you weren't. I thought that's not the plan.
No, but I'm going to ask you. I mean,
you can push, ask me every day?
Push means ask.
I haven't decided.
Tomorrow we'll have Mike's crushing defeat by the Red Sox tonight. Well, now I'm going.
That's on your notes.
But
you read that off. You premeditated that after you said you'd root.
I'm rooting for them.
You.
I'm rooting for them, but I think they're going to lose.
You read that. He had it prepared.
I saw.
That means it was in his head.
Written down. Yeah. I'm as guilty as Rush Limbaugh. Yes, I knew what I was going to say. They will disappoint you, and you get to hear Mike's reaction tomorrow.
I hope you're wrong.
And I do too. When I write this down for tomorrow's show, I'm trying to be realist.
I know it'll be more entertaining if they lose it.
Also, I got a great idea for Roy Horn.
Ah, good.
For me and Mike to go on some gay sex lines.
Very good.
As Alan and Michael.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Alan Linewand and Michael Hughes. And say, we're not there to get off. We're just there to share some memories about Roy Horn.
Yeah, that's nice. Even though he's alive. He's alive.
We've still not gotten to the most hated TV stars of all time. The sexual phobias.
Right.
We've now had a chance today to play Buzz with Greatness to find anybody who went to the JCPenney to see Buzz on Saturday.
Oh, I want to do that.
So much. This is a good place to be in.
Yes, it is.
We've got so much to get to. And now we're trying a brand new one. Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now?
Let's go to Heather, who says...
Heather.
She's in a library. Heather.
Yes.
Now, I don't know if we believe...
How do you prove you're in a library, Heather?
You can talk to the librarian or some of the student asses.
Oh, wait. What, do they just have magazines in there? Comic books?
There's a couple books.
Nova, for those of you around the country, is 13th grade.
And where's that located? Where's that located in Manassas, ma'am?
It's right by, do you know where Cracker Barrel is?
Yep. Okay, she's telling the truth.
Yeah.
Because I know exactly where that is.
Northern Virginia Community College. Nova. Great car. Mm-hmm. Great.
I kind of believe her. She gave the right landmark.
Right.
All right. Just,
you know I like me the Cracker Barrel.
Okay. Do me one favor. If you're in the library, go to what's the nearest section?
I'm standing by books on directors.
Okay. Can you open a book and close it hard?
No. Read off the first 15 books you see in front of you. Just the titles.
Can you say that again?
Read off the first 15 titles you see.
Oliver Stone, USA, Steven Spielberg, Sidney Lamont, Stanley Kubrick, George Lucas.
She's not lying. There's no way she's lying.
Okay.
There's no way she's lying.
How crowded is the library?
Hello?
How crowded is the library?
Hello?
Darling?
What happened to her?
Heather?
Oh, dear.
Heather?
Home for books.
A shelf fellow.
No, I'm joking.
I worked hard to try to come up with this.
This is totally different.
Heather? She's gone.
Wow.
She was telling the truth.
Wonder what happened.
We have to put people through the
inquisition. Don and Mike show. Hello, who's this?
Hello.
No, I'm sorry. Forget it. Not with you. Hi, Don and Mike. Who's this?
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, this is Don and Mike. We're doing the radio show. You called us. Where are you calling from?
The Manassas Mall.
The Manassas Mall. Now.
Where are you in the Manassas Mall?
Well, I was in the Ruby Tuesdays, but it was dead in there. So I came out here to the middle of the mall where the clock is, and there's a lot of people around.
All right, can you please describe everything you see around you?
Well, I'm standing right next to the clock. In front of me, there's a Hex. See, behind me, there's Mrs. Fields. Behind that, a Claire's, a Kay Jeweler, a Zales Jewelers, and a Hallmark.
All right, it's here on the East Coast, it's 20 till 6.
Pulling out my local knowledge here, he's telling the truth.
It's 20 till 6, generally not the heaviest mall traffic.
And you'll get a nice echo there, too. You know, if you wanted to go over to one of those benches and just sit your phone down, then you could, well, you couldn't hear us, thankfully.
No, he's got to keep the phone by his ear. How crowded is what mall is he at again, Mike? The
Manassas Mall.
Manassas Mall?
You know what I was going to tell you, though? When we give you the instructions on what to say, Every time you get your instructions, then pull the phone away from your mouth and hold it up and scream what you're going to say.
All right, at the shopping mall, I think if we're going to play, can you hear me now? We'll give you $10 for every command that you scream out. You can win as much as $100.
All right, very good.
How crowded is the mall in general, the area that you're at?
I want to say there's probably about 30 to 50 people around.
Okay.
Including people in the stores.
Now, for $10.
Okay.
To open things up.
To get rolling.
All right.
To get everything started, here's what you have to say.
And remember, after Don gives you the command, you pull the phone away from you, hold it up, and then scream it.
Yes, sir.
Has anyone experienced painful rectal itch?
Has anyone experienced painful rectal itch?
Okay, that's $10, Mike. But I think he's got to do it louder.
Yeah, a little louder, all right?
A little louder? Okay.
Yes. All right, now, at the top of your lungs, I mean,
yes,
so
sir.
We can all hear it, and pull the phone away. Will someone please give me a bath?
Will someone please give me a bath?
Okay, that's $20. Mm-hmm. For $10 more, and very loud, I just ate a piece of rat in my Mrs. Fields cookie.
Okay. I just ate a piece of rat in my Mrs. Fields cookie.
Ready?
How's it going?
Ready.
How's it going?
Oh, people are staring.
Now, real
loud. What are you looking at?
Real loud. Does anyone want to pet my snake?
Does anyone want to pet my snake?
Are we keeping track of how many we've done here?
Yeah, that's four. Okay, now
walk away. And if people walk up to you, walk away from them like
walk
a crazy
away from
man.
Them. Okay.
Yes, right. Don't engage in any conversation.
You got it.
All right, are you ready for another one?
Yes.
Really loud.
Okay.
My panties are sopping wet.
My panties are sopping wet.
That's 50. He's made it halfway through.
All right, ready?
Ready.
I think I soiled my Dockers.
I think I soiled my Dockers.
Okay, where are you now? What stores are you looking at?
I'm walking away from the security guard. I'm down near the Claire's.
Security guard's getting you. All right, he's going. We got to give him some more. How many more do we have for him?
I think he's got four more.
Six down, four to go.
All right.
Four more. Okay. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Hey, gang, I'm over 70 inches.
Hey, gang, I'm over 70 inches.
70 inches.
Ready? Nice and loud.
Okay.
I'm baking yeast rolls between my pillows.
I'm baking yeast rolls between my pillows.
Two more.
He's catching up. Okay.
Free Rush Limbaugh.
Free Rush Limbaugh!
All right, even louder. You got to do it louder. All right, ready? My groin is burning!
My groin is burning!
There it is.
Is that it?
Is that 10?
That's 10.
Yeah.
That's it. Now, what kind of reaction are you getting?
Oh, everybody's staring at me. I'm the security guard just trying to catch up.
What did Rob give you?
Do you want to give him a bonus?
Well, tell me what it is. Show me what it is, because I know Rob wrote it down. And then we can have a meeting. That's worth another $10.
All right. Top of your lungs. This has got to be really loud, though, okay?
Okay.
Live at the Manassas Mall.
Say, my prostate needs a milking.
My prostate needs a milking!
Now, nobody's approaching you on this, right?
Well, no, I doubled back, and the security guard missed me.
Now, somebody approached you before, but, of course, the thing is, if somebody approaches him, he has to walk away like a crazy man.
Now, the people who were approaching you before, what were they saying?
They said my daughter called to tell me that you were here on the radio.
There you go.
All right. Well, I don't know. I wasn't got. Is that 110, 120 bucks?
Yeah,
what is
110.
110. Way to go, yeah. Sir.
110. Thank you, my friend.
Excellent. Thanks, Chad.
Thank you. Now, obviously, this will get better with a better location.
Right.
That we can verify.
Mm-hmm.
I do see a couple of libraries up on the screen.
Good. Right.
Hard to verify library.
Yes, it is.
I want to tell you, we have to do a break. Sorry, we'll be right back. I do see funeral home.
Oh, my God. Good.
I do see. I see two libraries, one funeral home.
Wow!
I think we could lose the guy taking his dog to the vet. That's not really.
I want to put a request in for a fast food restaurant.
Yeah really. That
because it is the dinner hour on the East Coast.
That's and Mike, no matter where you are, there's always time for fast food.
Always
time. So if you want to play this again, we'll do it the same way. We can have more fun with it if you're in a better location.
Now, you're thinking what I'm thinking. How do you verify a funeral home? Who do you talk to?
We'll be right. Well,
bada bing.
Thank God, not Roy Horn.
Yes, thank God.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
You know, it's a funny kind of a thing, but you know, I feel better after I got all that off my chest. I feel like a load. A load is off my shoulders. You're good.
Doc.
Thank you.
Mr. Beatty, I didn't do anything.
Oh, you did something?
No, I did nothing.
You did something?
I didn't.
The load? Gone. Where is it? Don't know. You're good. Nah. You're good, Doc. You're good. I'm going to be getting in touch with you.
Don't, please.
Oh, just one more thing. If I talk to you and you turn me into a fag, I'm going to kill you. You understand?
Could we define fag? Because some feelings may come up.
I don't fag, you dang.
The Don and Mike Show.
That gravy, dog. The Don and Mike Show.
Here I am talking about tomorrow's show with all the stuff. Don't forget also tomorrow, live on the air, because we are syndicated, California erection results.
Oh, yeah.
We'll do our informal poll to find out how fast you guys in California elect Arnold, your new governor. That's on tomorrow's episode.
Wow.
Don't forget, it's confusing, but it's a real sign from Westwood One that we're getting something here.
Mm-hmm.
We have a trip to the premiere of Matrix Revolutions in Los Angeles.
Wow.
Call 888-898-6402.
Very good.
To enter. Enter as often as you like. We'll have the winner next week. It's a Westwood One thing. But it's only for people listening to this show.
Uh-huh.
It is a nationwide contest, but only for listeners of the Don and Mike Show.
And it's a hell of a prize.
Yeah.
And they sent over the copy. It says when you get someone, or you get the machine, it says, thank you for calling the Matrix Revolutions premiere giveaway for your chance to win a trip for two, including air and hotel for two nights, and passes to the premiere of Matrix Revolutions. Plus, 20 first prize winners get the Matrix DVD available. Brought to you by Warner Home Video at the Tone. Slowly and clearly state your age, name, and daytime phone number.
I'm dying.
Thanks. And good.
That's what you were thinking, wasn't it?
And all of that is too confusing when you get home.
Uh-huh.
Go to WJFK.com.
There you go. Will they just give you the phone number, though, or can you fill it out on the...
No, you can get the phone number if you go to WJFK.com. They can't fill it out for you if you go to WJFK.com.
Okay.
Remember,
so really, if it's too confusing for you, you're just going to delay the process of being confused if you go to the website.
No, you won't. You won't be confused at all because you go to the website and the phone number will be right there.
Yeah, but what you're saying is you went through what they're going to ask you to do. You gave out the phone number, and so it's not like the website will give you any more help.
Well, maybe someone's driving, they didn't remember the phone number.
Couldn't write it down.
That might be true. If it, sure. So the only confusing element would be is if you forgot the phone number.
The only confusion is between those 2 years I'm pointing at right now.
No, I see what you're saying.
I think I made a very salient point there. It's very easy to understand. If this is too much for you to comprehend...
You said go to the website, but nothing will be explained on the website.
Yes, it will.
Phone number.
No, it'll be... Oh, for goodness sake.
No, I'm not trying to be difficult.
Buzz, go to WJFK.com.
Right. That's what I was asking you. I said, is there any information on the website?
There should be. It should be laid
other
out.
Other than the phone number. I was saying, if they spell it out for you.
The phone number is really all you need.
Well, then you shouldn't say if it's too confusing for you, because you've given the phone number, you see.
But what if someone's in the car? And do you remember, without prompting, what's the phone number?
It's 1-888-898-6402.
There it is. First thing that comes up.
Okay, good. Did you write that down or
no,
remember it?
It's a very rememberable, but it's a memorable phone number.
But let's say you're going through a regular day.
Right.
Like regular people do. And you don't have the time to focus in, and it's just one of those things.
Then I'd go to the website.
There you go.
Not confusing. And Buzz, what does it say?
It says, win a trip to Los Angeles to attend the premiere of Matrix Revolution from now until Monday, October 13th. Call 888-898-6402 to enter. All you have to do to win a trip to L.A. is call 888-898-6402.
See, you're right. There it is. Twice. How foolish of me for bringing that up.
And then there's a lovely picture of Jim Nantz.
Ah, good.
What's he doing there?
It announces that he makes his weekly picks on CBSSportsLine.com.
Sometimes late.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's from Westwood One. That prize is valued at $3,500.
That's fine. That's good. I'm really not trying to be difficult. I'm just trying to be helpful.
Yeah. I know you are.
And you know, I know I shouldn't do that often.
Go ahead. Rob gave you a prompt. What did he give you?
I don't care for films.
See, that's Rob just wanting you to be argumentative.
I know. And I see I wasn't going to read that.
You're easy going, but I saw you look at it.
I don't read everything he puts in my head. I read most of them. I'd say it's about 80%.
All right, let's see if we can get one more winner on... Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Very good.
Remember Heather, who said she was on I think she was another library person?
Mm-hmm.
Heather?
Yes.
And then we lost her?
Right.
Here's Heather, who still claims she's in the library.
Yeah.
What the hell's that beep, beep, beep?
Yeah, wait a minute.
Heather?
Tommy?
Uh-uh.
Sorry.
Don't like beep. I know what that means.
Not thick enough. Let's go to...
I really don't. Okay.
Just makes me... Let's go to Chris. Chris!
Yeah.
Now, Chris, you are calling from where?
Spokane, Washington.
Right. On KJRB. That's our fine affiliate in Spokane. And you are where, sir?
I am in the Spokane Valley Library.
All right. Are you near books right now?
I'm near books. They're everywhere.
What section of the library are you in?
There's poetry, dog stories, cat stories.
Go to cat stories.
Cat stories.
Are you in a retarded library?
What kind of
dog stories, cat stories?
If I can read the other books.
Yeah, well.
Sounds like you're maybe looking at your personal book collection.
No, I don't think so.
All right, what do the books say?
All right, what do the books say? There is Robert Penn Warren's Selected Poems, That Shining Place, Hope Through, Heart Songs. Lyrics of Low Brow.
Hey, do me a favor. Pick up any one of those books.
Okay.
And on the spine of the book, by where the title is, there should be some numbers.
811 Service 1951.
Okay.
I mean, I was going to the old...
How many people are in the library?
The old
right
Dewey
now?
Decimal thing.
There's about 20 people. There's upstairs and downstairs.
What's the Dewey Decimal number on another book there?
There's 811.008.
That sounds right. I'll go with this guy. Okay. And how crowded? Did you say how many people?
20 people, Donnie. He said 20 people are there.
Okay. Are you ready?
Yes.
There now, because you're in a library.
I am in a library.
You know what you want to do, though? You want to walk to the center of the library where the most people will be able to hear you.
Right.
Is there a place where people are sitting at a table reading?
There's about 5 people behind me.
What do you mean 5 people behind you? Be more specific.
There's a lady sitting down, a guy sitting down. There's a...
All right, so there are people who are reading in the library. About 5 of them are gathered relatively close to where you are?
Yes.
All right, walk very close to them.
Okay.
Let me know when you're there.
I'm right by some people right now.
All right, very loudly now.
You have to put, when he gives you the instruction, you have to take the phone away and say it out loud.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Am I the only one that hears birds?
Am I the only one that hears birds?
Ready?
Yes.
Who wants to taste my gravy maker?
Who wants to taste my gravy maker?
See, now we must wait for a second.
I don't trust him. I don't trust
because
him
someone,
at all.
Someone in the library... Okay, here's one to make sure. As loud as you can. I swear to God, I didn't know she was 15, okay?
I swear to God, I didn't know she was 15, okay?
What reaction are you getting now?
There's a guy laughing by me. There's a lady looking at me. She's laughing.
She's laughing, but you're in a library.
Right.
Yeah, but nobody's really paying attention to me.
Yeah, he's full of crap. He's just a bad contestant.
Maybe he was okay. Just that one didn't work out. Let's go to who's on this line. Hello.
Hi, Don.
Don and Mike show. Who's this?
This is Mike from Rochester.
Right on WHTK. Mike, where are you at, sir?
I am at a Travel Plaza on the New York State Thruway that has a Sbarro, a Burger King, and a Cinnabon.
All right, now.
Not bad.
Now, here you go. You're on the turnpike, and we all know these Vince Lombardi areas where you pull in, and they have the food court. And look, you can hear the ambiance.
Yeah, you can hear people in there. Is it crowded?
It is fairly crowded, given that it's dinner time. All the weary travelers are here getting their...
Okay, here we go.
Perfect.
Okay.
Here we go.
All right.
Number one. As loud as you can. A tiger ate Roy. A tiger ate Roy.
All right, twice. Right. A tiger ate Roy. A tiger ate Roy.
All right, right away. Ready? Nice and loud. My fingers taste like butt.
My fingers taste like butt. Okay, the Burger King people are getting a little upset.
Okay. You can't see me now that I'm invisible.
You can't see me now that I'm invisible.
All right, ready?
Yeah.
I pleasured myself on the Cinnabons.
I pleasured myself on the Cinnabons.
A little too easy there.
Louder.
You got to be louder.
All right.
All right. You want me to do it again?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
I did.
I pleasured myself on the Cinnabons. Oh, God.
This thong is riding up my ass.
Oh, no. This thong is riding up my ass.
Buzz, are you counting?
Yes, yeah, we're up to eight. We have two more to go.
You got two more. Mike.
Okay, bow to me. I'm the Burger King.
Hey, let me say something.
Loud, now, go.
Bow to me. I'm the Burger King.
All right, and one more.
This guy wants to beat me up because there's kids in here.
Oh.
Oh, God.
All right, how about this one, though? This one isn't dirty. How about just, let me see. Dudes, I need to get to California to vote.
Dudes, I need to get to California to vote.
What's the guy that got mad? What's he doing?
He's talking to the Cinnabon woman about calling the police. Oh. God, yeah, he really wants to kick my ass.
Can we go in through a bonus one?
Yeah, you want to go talk to the guy?
I got one if you got one.
Right, a bonus
should
one, sir.
Should I put the guy on the phone?
Sir,
no,
don't be angry. I wish to lay with you.
Loudly.
Sir, don't be angry. I wish to lay with you.
All right, here we go. Buzz, how many is that?
We're up to 11 now, yeah.
All right, I'll make it an even 150 if you yell this.
All right, he's going to get his cell phone to call the cops.
God hates all who are different.
God hates all who are different.
Wow, bravo. He did it. He earned
bravo.
It.
Bravo. And, you know, I just had a feeling he was legit.
Yeah. Oh, my God. I got to get out of here. This guy's going to kick my ass.
You can get out of there.
Yeah, go.
All right.
Get out of there.
Should I stay on hold or something? Or?
Yeah, hold on. Yeah, we'll give you your money. You got $150.
Oh, nice. Thank you, guys. You guys are the best.
We never even got to Walnuts. Here's what I had: a Walnuts constipated.
Oh, look, check it out. There's these truck full of payphones. He's calling 911 right now.
Man, rub me till I'm red.
I have what do you want from me? I'm retarded.
I'm fully at attention right now.
Let's see.
Hey, what are you laughing for me? I'm retarded.
Oh, well, now we're getting bonus play.
Yeah, these are free.
Bonus play with this guy.
Bathe me with your tongues.
Well, thanks, my friend. You did it right.
Thank you.
Good job, Ron.
Enjoy your money.
Ron, that's right. And it's pretty unlimited, the things we can have people say.
Yeah, thank you very much.
At a certain point, we tailor it to the particular venue.
Well, see, that's what we're going to come back to. We're going to come back to that
one. Yeah, good.
I like that.
Yeah,
someone
is no hunger cat. That guy in the library, though, he was a little shifty, didn't you think?
Yeah, I thought so. But the guy in the food court, I mean, he described it, and I heard the background noises.
Yeah. Yeah. Like the guy is going to kick my ass.
All right, his name is Mike. He will fascinate you. He is from Rochester, New York. WHTK, our affiliate station.
Long-time affiliate.
Yeah. That's how you do that.
In a world where owning a radio was strictly forbidden, one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
It's Buzz.
Hi, it's me.
He made it up.
Hey, you know, I just realized that, you know, hey, we've got so much great stuff that we didn't get to. Tomorrow, we'll be able to do the bit at some point where we call the gay sex line.
Yes.
Not looking to get off.
No. Just to say, think of Roy.
Think of Roy. Now, I know that that's not even the lead story today.
No.
With Buzz. I've been hipped to Buzz's news. You would think that Siegfried and Roy being mauled by the tiger would be our lead.
Everybody's talking about
Buzz,
it.
Buzz, what is your lead?
Until they hear this. So maybe this is why Ben Affleck bought a gun.
So you've got some stuff on Bennifer?
I do.
Okay, stay tuned, everybody.
Stay tuned for news and comments coming up on the Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike Show. That was very
professional.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
Don and Mike.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
All right.
Don and Mike Show.
Right, I know.
They have the best radio show on the radio. Don and Mike.
Right.
The Don and Mike Show.
It's time for Buzz's News and Comment now. Buzz is brought to you by Verimax. Give me a second. I'll just work us in one more time.
The Don and Mike Show.
Tomorrow I'm going to try to play all music that Buzz likes for his birthday.
Good.
This would be one of them, right, Buzz?
Absolutely.
Time for Buzz's News and Comment, brought to you by Verimax Sexual Pleasure Performance Enhancer.
Someone call for a doctor?
Yeah.
Someone call for a doctor?
Great news for the Tommy Dorsey fans.
Doctor developed, clinically tested Verimax works. Get it at Rite Aid, GNC, other select retailers. Try it today. Verimax, run 1-1-888-TRY. VMAX. And Buzz, let me mention again.
Yes.
People pay attention during the news part. We want to urge everyone to go to the car wash, the fundraiser by the Pentagon police officers for the Fraternal Order of Police. It's this Saturday, 9 a. to 4 p. here in the D.C. area, obviously, by the Pentagon. Navy Exchange Gas Station at the corner of Columbia Pike and Joy Street, right next door to the Pentagon.
Very good.
So it's the Pentagon police officers doing a fundraiser for the Fraternal Order of Police.
Good.
Just go down by the Pentagon.
Go there.
Saturday between 9 and 4.
Do it.
Right off Columbia Pike at the Navy Exchange gas station. So we're glad to promote that. And now here is Buzz with news on Bennifer.
Yes. Hi, Don and Mike. A warrant's been issued for the arrest of Ben Affleck after a woman accused him of threatening to kill her.
Was the woman Jennifer Lopez?
No, that was not the woman. Ooh. Not yet. This, according to the British showbiz website, PeopleNews.com.
Jesus.
Tara Ray, who says she and Ben were once lovers, was in a North Carolina courthouse over the weekend to ask for the warrant. She says Affleck followed her home and communicated threats to her. Quoting her, "I honestly believed my life was in danger. I am not out for publicity. I just wanted it known that he's very capable of doing this." Oddly, she says the threats came on September 25th, the day on which Ben and Jen were being followed by at least 50 photographers.
Well, they went to buy a gun.
Ben's lawyer says he doesn't even know this woman. And this is spin.
Stay cool.
This is
stay cool.
Spin that I'm not necessarily buying, but they're saying this whole threat and the charges associated with it are the reason they called off the wedding or postponed it.
What?
Yeah.
What? That kind of makes
sense. That's exactly the right reaction.
No, I kind of buy this. Yeah. If all of that was happening.
Right.
Why not?
So this is supposedly to have happened how long ago?
September 25th is the day she says he threatened her, but that was a day that he was being followed around constantly, he and Jen, by at least 50 photographers. No exaggeration.
So if he had followed somebody home,
somebody
they probably
would know
would be aware of it.
These guys, these photographers,
so what do you think, this lady's just a flake?
Like I said, Ben's lawyer doesn't even know of this woman. So that would be my guess.
Here's another conspiracy theory that I heard, unrelated to this, about Rush Limbaugh.
Okay.
That I heard from someone yesterday who works for the ESPN parent company.
All right.
This was just being tossed around.
Sure.
I'm just throwing it out there.
People talk.
That really there was no big stink about Rush Limbaugh's comments about Donovan McNabb on the Sunday that he made them or the Monday after. There was something, I guess, in the Philly papers on Tuesday, but it was a local issue, not a national story.
Right.
The person that I was talking to said, what if word had gotten to ESPN that Rush Limbaugh was about to be brought into this 4,000 oxy
cotton
the pill thing?
Yeah.
Boy, we got to dump his ass. We got to dump his ass yesterday.
Mm-hmm. That's entirely possible.
You know, after all, he did say this thing about Donovan McNabb.
That's possible.
Which normally we would take some heat on, but we'll let it slide. Hey, we'd rather be associated with him saying this about Donovan McNabb.
Oh, sure.
And get him the frig out of here before it started. Before we started, they got talking
well,
about,
they were aware
about
of it.
The pills.
If they were aware of it simultaneously, it would certainly help the decision to get him out of there.
Sure, makes sense.
But because either that's how it worked, or Rush Limbaugh last week had the worst possible week that someone in his position or to a lesser extent our position could have, that you get fired from ESPN.
You make that statement, you get fired, and then, oh, this drug stuff comes down.
Right.
All in 1 week.
Pretty weird.
All in 1 week. And like a schmuck, I went to the radio show today to Rush Limbaugh to turn it on. To hear about it.
To hear if he'd talk about it.
I hear no mea culpa. I hear no saying.
He's never done that.
Nothing.
I don't hear him saying, I was right, I was wrong, I'll tell you later. I hear him.
I have chosen to ignore it.
I hear him saying, and this is why the good people of California will elect Arnold Schwarzenegger. They will not listen for the, they will not stand for the innuendos, the lies. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, I'm sure I'm like most people looking at the radio saying, I don't care about this.
Right.
What's the deal with you and the pills, dude?
That's what America wants to know about.
That's right.
What's the deal?
Mm-hmm. Amazing. He's promised to come clean, but he hasn't said when.
Okay.
Well, although employees of Siegfried and Roy were told to look for new jobs, it appears Roy's going to be okay. The dark-haired half of the Las Vegas illusionist duo was in critical condition over the weekend after being attacked on stage by a tiger. It was the Tiger's first on-stage appearance and Roy's 59th birthday.
Oh, now, wait a minute. Now I read that it was, that he said this is his first appearance and that's a standard line from the show.
Okay, well, whoever came up with this information then bought that.
I don't want the Tiger to be hurt.
It happened. Yeah, he has said that, in fact.
And Buzz, your opening, I've got the music I need now. Your opening line, would you read it again?
Although employees of Siegfried and Roy were told to look for new jobs, it appears Roy's going to be okay. It's
raining, man. Hallelujah. Yeah, man, we can celebrate now. Yeah, even the Tigers are happy about that.
Maybe not okay enough to perform again.
Yeah, probably not.
He'll live.
Well, it was a hell of a run.
Happened about halfway through the show. The tiger bit into Roy's neck, nearly severing his carotid artery. Roy went limp, and the lion carried him off stage. At first, the audience...
Roy Horn, what's happened to Roy Horn?
At first, the audience didn't know anything had gone wrong. Quoting one spectator, I thought maybe it was some magic trick with a switcher ragdoll or something. The fact that Roy Horn is not already dead is considered an encouraging sign. Fortunately, there was...
Same with Rob Spiewak.
We always say that about Rob
wasn't attacked by anything this weekend.
But we always say it's fortunate that he's still alive.
Except maybe his wife.
That's true.
Fortunately, there was an ample supply of blood on hand at the hospital because he lost a lot of it. The doctors say they are cautiously optimistic, guarded. Roy's awake now, and although on a ventilator, is able to communicate. He said he doesn't, as Don mentioned, doesn't want the tiger, who's in quarantine now, killed. The white tiger is about 8 years old. And
weighs... Buzz, use the proper term. Destroyed.
Destroyed. Put down.
Whenever you're talking
put down.
About putting down an animal,
you got to say destroyed.
Destroyed.
You got to destroy.
People get killed, animals get destroyed.
All right. He said he doesn't want the tiger, who's in quarantine, destroyed. You can't spell destroyed without Roy.
And what was this part about his type of blood?
No, there were. It wasn't a matter of type. There just happened to be plenty on hand.
His type of blood.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you catch my drift.
Tiger's about 8 years old. Weighs about 600 pounds. It grabbed Roy by the neck when Roy bopped it on the head with a microphone, which he did after the tiger had bitten him on the arm.
There you go. That's how you fight.
That's it.
Jesus, I've said that a lot today,
and rightly so.
Now we got all the sound of that. Yeah.
All the tigers are on the stage now. Jesus, calm them down.
And Mike, let me just give you a brief peek behind the scenes.
Good.
That's our alligator sound.
Hey, Eric's lover.
Sounds a lot like a tiger.
That's the tiger.
Nice mix.
You know why? What's wrong with our sound effects when the alligator sounds more like a tiger?
All right, again.
Where's the tiger?
Hold on. I got to wait for him to recue.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay.
That's a tiger.
And that one hasn't recued yet. Okay, first, alligator. No, I'm kidding.
Very good.
I'm kidding.
And this could just be spin, but they say the attack on Roy is the reason that Ben and Jen delayed the wedding. So, today's Arnold story.
Now, alligator. Tiger. Oh, hold on. Tiger. Elephant. Chicken.
The palace heads.
Gay disco music. And a car.
With emphysema.
That's a sick cock. Someone needs to take that cock's temperature.
And of course, to wrap up any animal segment, an ass.
Okay.
Today's Arnold story isn't about Arnold at all. It's about the TV shows that make fun of him. The comedians who host these late-night shows have loved the election campaign. The lawyers for those shows have not. They have equal time laws to consider. Craig Kilborn says he found out 10 minutes before showtime that his planned Arnold and Gray Davis skit had to be cut. He says the lawyers, the CBS lawyers, told him that he couldn't even show a picture of Arnold without showing a picture of each of the other 134 candidates.
Stay cool. Stay cool.
That was in August. Later, the CBS lawyers let up and told Kilborn and Letterman they could do Arnold stuff so long as they just mocked Arnold. Quoting a producer, the lawyers are being cautious the way lawyers tend to be.
Oh, boy.
Didn't they have a thing on Gray Davis on Mad TV?
Yeah, it was very funny.
Oh, I haven't seen it yet. I can't wait.
Funny show.
Where they made him get smaller and smaller.
No, better than that, they made him actually dissolve.
As the
poll results were coming back, he just faded away. It was great.
Jesse Ventura's TV show premiered Saturday night. Jesse Ventura's America on MSNBC.
My America was something that you really got to realize. You know, these effing people paying attention to Arnold don't realize that I've got a great show.
Mm-hmm.
A great goddamn show.
What is it, Jesse?
Jesse's America.
All right.
What's it about?
It's about me and my vision for America.
Like what?
Like the fact that I think everyone should be required to have a fishing license.
How do you feel about Roy Horn?
I'm really broken up about that. No, come on. If you work with tigers, you're going to get burned. Come on. And we need more pinball machines. My America by Jesse Ventura. No, check that. Jesse effing Ventura.
Jesse F. Ventura.
That's right. Don't you forget it. I was a SEAL.
Yeah.
For Christ's sake.
It was supposed to have been a nightly show, but there were problems in rehearsals, of format changes, and other obstacles, so it was relegated to Saturday nights when viewership is low.
Don't challenge the mind. Jesse the Mind Ventura.
Jesse acknowledged the delays in getting the show on the air.
No, I didn't. I said acknowledge this. Well, and I grabbed my crotch.
Something like that. He thanked the network for finally having the courage to put it on the air.
That's right. No, the balls.
His first guests were Gray Davis and Arianna Huffington via satellite, but
fag.
Ventura was unable
Bitch.
To spark the debate he clearly wanted.
Right.
His yes and no questions get the blame for that not happening.
Yes and no.
Mostly.
What flavor do you like? Chocolate ice cream? Yes. Do you hate people that are mean?
You know, while we're in this mode.
Yes, no.
And Fred, maybe, you know, because I know the show.
Eyeballs.
The show is heard in Bakersfield, California, San Francisco, Oakland.
A heck of a country. That California.
Sacramento. For those of you out there who are still able to breathe and make decisions.
I started this whole effing thread.
Conscious decisions like right on red.
Right.
And you know, when you come to a stop sign, you understand.
And don't pass the effing school bus.
You realize you stop and you look all ways and then you go. For those of you who have passed that simple test, let me just ask you something real.
Yeah, what is it, Don?
What the F are you going to do tomorrow? What the F are you going to do? Listen, this is what happened in Minnesota.
Hey, if they're not doing nothing, tune into my balls.
I'm telling you something. This is nothing.
Nothing. Yeah. What are you talking about? You want to fight?
Compared.
You want to fight me?
Compared to what you're going to get with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Christ, you're not kidding about that. I was dumb. He's a moron.
Thank you.
That's right. And I challenge him. If he has a problem with that, he can fight my balls. He can fight my balls.
Well, while the bigger names in Hollywood are running for office or just making movies and TV shows, the not-so-big names are finding work.
How's Leah?
This could be a future for her through HollywoodIsCalling.com. For $20, you can arrange your mom or whoever to get a 30-second call from the likes of Lou Ferrigno, Horshack from Welcome Back, Kotter.
Oh, wow.
Andrea Thompson, formerly of CNN and NYPD Blue. There's Lorenzo Lamas and Todd Bridges.
Sounds like the upcoming guest list for the Don and Mike Show on Westwood One.
Quoting Ferrigno, people get very excited. It's like a treat for them. They get tickled to death. And
ding, 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 ding.
They can't stop thanking.
Ding, 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 for them.
They can't stop thanking me enough for calling.
Thank you, New.
Hey, oh. Hey, Buzz, is Clooney on that list?
Not yet, no.
Clooney,
no.
You tasteless bastard.
He's still in town, isn't he?
Still in town, still so. Right here in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, I got a look at that K Street last night.
It's an awful TV show.
Oh,
I mean, it's got the shaky camera lens.
Oh,
it's got,
please.
It's got too much of James Carvel and well, Mary Matlin.
They should just get her off the camera. Get her off camera, I mean.
Oh, not
I don't know what I mean.
You ever watch a show like that, though, and you think, you know, James Carvel, he's no picnic. I mean, he's no Clooney. He's no me.
I'd rather watch my balls.
You know, just think about her climbing on top of him.
Oh, yeah, no,
they get
you.
Done to that show.
Right.
Same thing, I think sometimes I watch Kathleen Matthews on Channel 7. Mm-hmm. She's a local on ABC here in D.C., and she's married to that tool, Chris Matthews. Something about him climbing up on her is big, bad walrus, flabby skin.
Yeah, but with James Carville, it never happens with her, with Mary in the conventional way. He beams her up to his spaceship.
Well, then just think about Chris Matthew. Hey, Jesse, you know the name of the show is, right?
What's that?
Hardball.
Hardball. That's my tune.
Hardball.
Take a look at him.
Hold on there,
they're,
Buzz.
They're right. Winking at you.
Let me say, we'll have complete erection coverage.
Yes.
Complete
California. Watch your language
solid.
There, boy.
Erection coverage on tomorrow's show.
Right. Tiger Pride.
Be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
We're going to dance. We're going to dance. We're going to dance and have some fun.
Say what?
Broadcasting in black and white as an infinity cost-cutting measure. The Don and Mike Show.
Dig, right. Dig. And now, here's Buzz.
Hi, Donna Mike.
Almost 60 years old.
That's right.
Tomorrow.
Phenomenal.
Tomorrow is Buzz's birthday.
He's doing so well.
And he's going to be 60 tomorrow.
Never, it's very exciting. Never felt better.
6-0 tomorrow for Buzz.
60 years old and still so young looking.
We're kidding. We're kidding. You should know we kid, Buzz. Right. He'll be 58 tomorrow.
That's right.
58 years old. Happy birthday, Buzz.
We exaggerate, but it's just 58.
Happy birthday.
If you knew someone...
I kid.
Yeah?
He's going to be 59 tomorrow.
Yeah. They're not 58, 59. Well, why are we lying? He's going to be 65 tomorrow. he likes Social Security tomorrow.
He's very old. Yeah, he's an old man. I mean, he still gets it done. I give him credit. He gets it done.
Octogenarian Buzz Burbank.
AARP, Member of the Month.
That's right. That's right.
Buzz Burbank tomorrow. All right, now, for real.
Uh-huh.
Tell everybody how old you'll be tomorrow.
Oh, God. This kills me. I'll really be 50. Audience, that's not funny.
That is a birthday you want somebody to hit before you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I do want somebody to hit it before me.
Congratulations, Buzz. Halfway to Willard's greeting.
That's right.
That's right. You're halfway to Smucker's.
A few more jars of Smucker's
to
go.
It came up quick, didn't it?
Yeah, it sure did.
Yeah.
Where did the time go?
You don't look fitty.
Thank you. Right. I don't feel it. Feel great.
And I'll tell you something, you're a better man than I, because...
Don, baby, how's it going?
That's part of the reason I'm on the plan that I'm on, with this show and the contract and stuff.
Right, right.
When I'm 50...
Yeah.
And I'm glad that you don't feel this way, Buzz.
No.
But when I'm 50, I don't want to be doing this.
No, I'm still...
I mean,
we share that, pal.
When I'm 50, I want to be in radio, I have a great time, and maybe I'll change my mind as I get closer to 50.
Right.
But... The more I think about what we do...
I know. I don't want to be doing this.
See, this is where you and I differ, because at 50, I'm fine with making appearances at the mall.
So. There you go.
Touché, and tomorrow we will be playing Buzz with Greatness.
Very, very good.
Good luck with that.
Not Brush with Greatness. Buzz, how many people showed up for your JCPenney appearance on Saturday?
I'm going to say easily a dozen.
You know. Oh, God.
Yeah.
12 people?
Yeah. Well, I was there only 2 hours, so...
6 an hour?
Yeah.
And what kind of contact did you have with those people at JCPenney during your live appearance?
Really nothing but the best. Met a girl named Ken.
Really?
Yeah.
Pretty?
I met a girl named Ken.
Oh. No, she never says nothing about nobody.
She was cute. Yeah.
Any of the people hang around too long for your liking?
No, didn't have that problem.
Yeah.
Met the lovely Lois.
10 a.m. at the mall. That's not a good time at the mall under any circumstance.
Oh, it was for me.
It is if you're doing a personal appearance,
I suppose.
Okay.
If you knew someone who knew...
And you're 50.
Yeah.
And tomorrow you're 50.
That's a milestone. My God, the whole day ought to be Buzz's.
It just keeps getting better.
Who would have thought, Buzz? Mm-hmm. Who would have thought?
Yeah.
You ever dream when you're growing up in Kansas that someday you'd be 50,
no,
working on a nationally syndicated radio show, but at the same time, doing great appearances at JCPenney's on Saturday morning?
Yeah, look at that, huh? No, I never dreamed of that.
Have you been?
I agree.
Have you been reflecting at all, on your life?
Whatever.
I've been researching suicide methods.
No,
go out and take a look at it.
Come on.
Yeah. No, I'm
because
fine.
It's true.
Fine with it, yeah.
These tapes are of Redskins owner Jack Kencook when he was 50.
You're damn right.
See how much better I sound?
That's right.
I'm liable to lose you.
Nah, you'll make it to 51.
Fire me.
I can't fire you. You're dead.
I'm scared stiff.
What? Almost sound like he was to say, I'm scared.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You know, I've always had trouble hearing you.
There. 50-year-old Jack Kencook.
Can't hear a word you say.
Exactly, Jack.
Happy birthday greetings a day early to Buzz.
I'm not here.
You're not here.
Next question.
All right,
oh,
Buzz.
Man. If you knew someone who needed a spine, this was the guy to go see.
What is it?
In California, a crematorium owner's been sentenced to 20 years for selling body parts to medical researchers.
I beg pardon?
Including spines... And knees.
What was the question?
And heads. 44-year-old Michael Francis Brown got the maximum when he appeared for the judge. That was after he pleaded guilty to 66 counts of mutilation and embezzlement.
I can't hear you.
For pleading guilty, they dropped another 200
charges. I beg your pardon?
He was facing. He had apparently made nearly $500,000 with this scam. Quoting a widow, I was asked to identify my husband's head.
Yee.
You'll never know how horrid an experience that was.
Nice head.
Yeah. For the husband, too.
Hey, if Madonna can write
good
books...
Good head.
If Madonna can write books, then why not Mariah Carey? Word is Mariah's about to close a deal on writing her autobiography.
This is the story of the one-faced bitch.
It's being pitched as an inspirational story about her humble beginnings, growing up as a biracial child, and of course, what we all now know as her breakdown. Mariah's people say there's a lot of interest in the book, even if no one's yet agreed to publish it.
There's not a lot of interest in Mariah Carey, period.
Exactly. Well,
she's got to do what she's got to do.
I mean, and there's not a lot of interest in her, period.
Yeah, well, I can understand that.
Normally, I'm right there. Sure. Someone says Mariah Carey having a period, I'm there.
Sure, not anymore, though.
Now I don't care.
You used to run when somebody'd say that. Mariah's period.
Run! Run!
In sports, the undefeated Indianapolis Colts visit the defending Super Bowl champs tonight in Tampa Bay on Monday Night Football, and Red Sox fans are anxiously awaiting tonight's game against Oakland in a division playoff series that's tied at 2-2.
Not that anxious. Oh, yeah, it's about as good a sound effect as you can play.
Note my careful use of the word anxiously, which
I'll drink to that.
Yes. Filled with anxiety.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Click, click, click.
You use the word properly.
I'll drink to that.
Thank you, sir. Finally, the season is closing on outdoor sex, but in Columbia, South Carolina, a neighbor called 911 last week to report a couple having sex on their front lawn. Quoting the neighbor, they're having sex out there and people are running by. When police arrived, they found the couple on the ground. The man was wearing only underwear, pulled down just enough to accommodate the act. The woman was wearing a sweater and no pants at all. They were charged with indecent exposure.
She was a whore.
Police say they also found a couple of empty vodka bottles in the yard. I'm Buzz Burbank.
Hi, Ken. Hi, Roz. What have you kids been doing since you've been fired?
Sorry, Buzz. I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
It was Ken and Roz.
Yeah.
No! No way, not Ken and Roz.
Hey, you're the same age as Ken.
Oh. Oh, but I'm employed.
Touche!
That's right.
All right, Buzz. We'll see you tomorrow with a new episode.
Good day to you, sir.
Good luck to the Sox tonight.
Good day to you, sir. Thank you.
Tomorrow with a new episode. Don't forget, Wednesday night, we're all going to the Titty Bar.
Mm-hmm.
It's Crystal City Restaurant.
Right.
Crystal City, Virginia. I'll be there with Tom, and Mike will be there with everybody else.
Absolutely.
Come and watch my horror. Hey, Double C, you ready?
You know, tomorrow, Buzz can get into the movies cheap.
Okay, we will see you tomorrow.
P.M.
Peter.
Till we meet again, this is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.